It's Friday, you bastard.
Hi, this is OJ. Since I've been released from jail, I like to keep track of my bitches. So I recommend to you new OJ Simpson's Bitch Jack for Women. Believe me, brothers, you won't get Jack with Bitch Jack. Just attach the small homing device to your bitch's leg, and you can track her all around town. And just in case she cheating, she'll get a beating. You see, when your woman be messing around, new Bitch Jack for Women lets out an inaudible beeping sound that only you can hear. And once they catch her, she's all yours.
Excuse me, Mr. Simpson. We tracked down your old lady with a white man. What shall we do with her?
Why, thank you, officer. I'll handle this. You bitch. Don't you know I'm tracking you with Bitch Jack? I'm gonna cut your throat, you bitch. I'm gonna keep...
So remember, your hoes won't get very far with O.J. Simpson's new Bitch Jack for Women. Hey, just because O.J.'s free don't mean your bitches got to be free, too.
Bitch Jack.
What's this obsession with Hokey?
Yes! Yes!
There's a dream that lives deep in every heart.
Oh.
Heroes call their name, legends leave their mark. And it's worth the sweat, and it's worth the pain. 'Cause the chance may never come again.
Gord Murphy back out. Then Straka hustling again. Great move by Straka. Bill Lindsay. Then Straka scores!
Oh!
Lemieux with 6 points in the series and 26 points in the playoffs. So he now trails Joe Sakic by a couple in that race. As he tries to join Sakic in the Avalanche in the Stanley Cup Championship Series. There's a rebound. Niederbach scores! Nedved will take the faceoff for Pittsburgh against Brian Strudlin. Lemieux poised in behind Nedved. But the Panthers win the draw. Fitzgerald gets it down. Zubov hustling back. Rings the boards to Daniel. He was hit by Huff. Now 20 seconds left, and the Penguins will have to hurry. Here's the shoot-in, and Yager's first one to it. Off Kartner and back out. And this amazing story is going to continue. The Florida Panthers have forced Game 7.
Yeah.
Marty Straka, God.
Oh!
What I tell you guys, just leave the lineup to me and leave the playing to these guys. We'll be all right. What a night. What a night. One of the most incredible nights in it. I was never nervous. Never had any doubts, especially when Yager went in there with a minute to go or whatever was in the game. Oh, never nervous at all. Thank God for those towels, man. Now I know what Jerry Tarkanian was chewing on it all those years in the towel, too. Man, oh, man, does that thing come in handy? I wouldn't have any teeth. I'd look like Radek Dvorak today if I didn't have that towel, man. I was biting and clenching and squeezing, and, oh, God, what a night. So I wonder what, I didn't have a chance this morning to see the Herald. I wonder what Greg Kotex is writing this morning in the Herald. What's he going to say now, huh? Mr. Smarty Pants, that we were going to lose to Pittsburgh in six games. Mr. Let's Pee on Your Parade, huh? So typical for this town. We finally, after 1,000 years, we finally got something good going on here we can be excited about. And we got a bunch of little people there, especially at the Herald, who want to pee on our parade. Too bad. Ain't going to work. And, of course, you know what Mario and Yager both said. They said Game 7 is a bad thing because anything can happen. No matter where it's played, there's really no such thing as home ice advantage in Game 7. A little unlucky bounce over here, a little bad deflection over there, and all of a sudden, Panthers are in the goddamn finals. How do you like that? So what can I tell you? It's just one of the most miraculous things I've ever seen. I bet you there isn't going to be anybody talking negative about it today. Make no mistake about it. There will be nobody saying anything negative about it today. They're all going to be on the bandwagon. They're going to be falling all over each other. Every plane to Pittsburgh is going to... They're going to be people on the wings on U.S. gear. They're going to be all over those planes on the way to Pittsburgh. That town is going to have more damn Floridians in it than you've ever seen because, quite frankly, who the hell would want to go there otherwise? So I hope you had a good time there last night. We're going to, like, sit back and just pee all over the Panthers today and over Doug MacLean, who was wise enough to listen to my coaching chat. I told the guy, you know, if you want to do it your way, Game 5 would be a good time, okay? It's not a good idea, but if you want to try it your way, I'll give you one game. He tried it his way. It was a bomb. Even the Japanese never saw a bomb like that. And so he said to me, okay, we'll do it back your way. We'll put Woolley in there in the power play. We'll dress seven defensemen, and we'll put Strock in there. And how about that line, by the way? Three of the four goals coming off the same line. Niedermeyer, Straka, and Mellenby all of a sudden even woke up playing on that same line. How do you like that?
Oh!
I liked it. Let's get Greg Kotex online. Let's see what he has to say, okay? In fact, you still got that voicemail for the Herald? For Greg Kotex, get that out while we're doing the break. I want to make sure that everybody lets him know how much we appreciate his fine journalism.
376.
What is it?
376.
376.
3492.
3492. 376-3492. Let Greg Kotex over the Herald know how much we appreciate what a great enthusiastic fan he is. 1013 at WIOD.
Now, where was everybody at this party when you and your old lady were doing it on top of the dinner table?
There was only three other couples, and they knew us in high school, and they were right there. They were watching the whole thing.
Passion Phones, 8 p.m. till midnight on News Talk and Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
Okay, 1016 at WIOD. Let's see, we got, what is this? Oh, we got a couple of faxes here. One says that Greg Fadix got, they heard his voice on air yesterday, and he must be hung like an elephant. Now, I want to tell you who the guys are who hung bigger than anybody in the world. And, of course, I haven't been in the shower like Mandich. I haven't been in a locker room, although it might be kind of interesting. But the Florida Panthers, man, are hung like dinosaurs, like gigantic monsters from outer space. I've never seen guys with such big ones as these guys. You know, last night we get the early goal, the disputed goal, and we're ahead 1-0, and it looked like we caught an early break there, which really was a big thing. And then the Penguins tie it up in the second period. They take the lead 2-1. And the opening part of that period, man, they came out, they outshot us 9-0 in the start of the second period. I thought, uh-oh, we're in big trouble. Then we outshot them, I think it was 16-1 in the rest of that period. Can you believe that, 16-1? But in the meantime, they had taken a 2-1 lead, and really the turning point in all of the stuff last night was Billy Lindsay's goal. And this kid, here's an unsung hero, man. Here's a kid who just does everything out there, and nobody, gives him a lot of credit. But Billy Lindsay, he scores the big one. He had that incredible goal against the Bruins, you know, the one that's on at the lithograph. He's just done so many incredible things. And yet when you talk about the Panthers, very few people first will say, hey, Billy Lindsay, there's the guy that really, rocks that ship. But when he tied it up there, and it was kind of a, you know, we got traffic in front of Barrasso. That's what you got to have. And when he got that rebound and stuck it in there, that turned the whole night around. And then we take the 3-2 lead. My buddy Marty Straka, what a move, baby. What a move. He's got moves that most guys in the league could only dream of having. And he gets the perfect return pass from Billy Lindsay, like I said, and sticks it in there. And then the Penguins come back and tie it up 3-3. Now, at that, and Mario, talking about moves, he just faked everybody out of their jock, passed it right in front to Sandstrom. He's all alone. It's 3-3. At that point, you figure, oh, geez, maybe we're going to go to overtime, and we don't like overtime to begin with, and it's a dangerous thing. And all of a sudden, less than 2 minutes later, here we are, and here's Niedermeyer, who is really butched up on that line. Like I told Doug MacLean, since you put him out there with Straka, man, he is butched up all of a sudden. This kid is dynamite. And he gets his own rebound and sticks it in there like you just heard. That's it. One of the most phenomenal sporting events in history. Even though it's only game six of the semifinals, I do understand that. But is there anything else that could happen that could possibly be better, except, of course, winning Saturday and going on to the finals, which would really piss off the media, too bad, and really piss off Greg Kotex and some of the other local pee on your paraders. Now, what was it? Defoe picked Pittsburgh in six. Nice going, Defoe. Here's a mobile in West Palm Beach. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
I only got a couple of things to say. First off, I'm, you know, always big Panther fan. It's just unbelievable. I'm almost speechless. Last night, I couldn't get tickets to the game. I tried. I was going nuts in my house. I swear I thought my heart was going to jump right out of my chest.
Yeah.
I got a soundbite if you want one for you.
Yeah.
Marty Straka. I love you, man.
Oh! All right.
Also, I'd like to call my friend John out there. John, I know you're listening right now. You're a big, fat, wet, hairy douchebag. Neil, Panthers!
All right.
Stanley Cup, it's ours, baby.
Okay, get out of here. We have an open line on the green line, 1-800-944-9463, 1-800, and Rick Riley, I noticed they spent, because I heard some of the show, I had a meeting this morning, by the way, with the Paxson people over there in North Dade, and they were extraordinarily nice to me, and it was nice to see Pete Bolger again, and a whole bunch of people, virtually everybody in that building I've worked with. Of course, I guess when you're in the market for 20 years, you've worked with virtually everybody. And it was great. And they love me. They love George, even, which goes to show you how he pulled the wool over their eyes. Exactly. And it was great. It was a very positive thing. I just mentioned that because I know that even people in the audience are having a lot of consternation and constipation and getting all bent out of shape. And, you know, and it is a very sad thing that Phil's not going to be a part of what we're going to be doing. But other than that, I don't perceive a whole lot of changes. I think there's going to be a lot of continuity in what we're doing and what you like and et cetera. And life goes on. Thank God. Okay, here's Fort Lauderdale on the Purple Line. Hello.
Yeah, hi, Neil. How you doing?
I'm doing phenomenal. How about you?
Sensational after last night. I tell you, you said you weren't a little nervous, and my wife and I were sweating our brains out.
I'm going to tell you. In fact, I saw last night on the when I got the highlights off the tape, I saw this reaction of Brian Murray and Bill Torrey up in the box when we let Yager walk in there and nearly tie it up in the last minute or two. And I was biting that towel so bad, and I had my hands around my head. I mean, that was a gut-wrenching moment that I'll never forget. Thank God the Beezer was, like, right on top of it at that moment, or we could still be playing.
Yeah, because what was amazing is when we scored and then we tied up, and they tied,
right,
and then they got a goal, and we got a goal. I mean, it was going back and forth. I said, the last goal is going to win. But I said that a little bit too premature, but it was great. All I could say
and by the way, by the way, 40 shots last night again. This is the team that's supposed to be boring. 40 shots, 61 shots last Friday, and here's the team. So that's over 100 shots in two of the games in the series, and yet we're the team that's supposed to be boring, right?
Yeah. Well,
who
like
the hell
I
are
said,
they kidding?
I can't thank you enough because you're the one that got me back into hockey. I used to watch it many, many years ago, and when I lived up in New York a long time ago, and it is the greatest.
It is the greatest.
And especially
Stanley Cup playoff hockey, man. There's, I don't care, World Series, Super Bowl, there's nothing like the Stanley Cup playoffs.
That's true. Well, I need your help, though. One problem.
Right.
Tomorrow night, I got four tickets for my wife and I and some good friends that we haven't seen in a long time to go to the baseball game. The only problem is tomorrow night's the hockey game. What am I going to do? I could bring a radio and I could tape the game, but it's still not being there.
Yeah.
What am I going
to
do?
Find some people that want to go see a baseball game. Find some underprivileged kids or something.
You mean just give my tickets to my friends and tell them to use it whatever they want?
Sure. Sure.
Yeah.
Stay home.
Is the greatest
Stay glued
in the world.
To your TV, man. It's going to be great.
Oh, I'm going to have to do something. My wife will divorce me, though.
We might just shock the hell out of her. The hell, listen, if she's that fickle, who needs her?
Yeah, that's true.
Get your
true.
Priorities
that's
straightened
true.
Out.
It'll be cheaper without her.
And there you go. Okay, pal.
Okay. Have a great day, Neil.
And back to
Bye.
You. Open line on the Purple Line. That's Mobile One Cell, AT&T Wireless, Pound. Yeah, I'm in my glory because this is something that I love, and I've been promoting it for years and years, especially the last three since we had a team here. And by the way, did anybody see? I'm sure you did because I know they put it on the cameras. When Wayne and Marty Huizenga were doing a thing there after Straka's goal, they were... It's an incredible thing. Forget about all the money, at least for a minute or two, okay? I mean, we got a couple of fans there. Like I told you, when they came back from the loss in Pittsburgh the other night, 3-0 loss, there's two people meeting them at 2:30 or 3 in the morning at the airport, and it's Wayne and Marty Huizenga. These are fans now, man. That's what's got me excited. All the other stuff, well, we can discuss that. But these are a couple of real fans. So if you really believe he's selling this team, man, I got some real cheap land in the middle of the sawgrass for you. 10:23 at WIOD.
Every Sunday night at 11 p.m., the rookies take over 610 WIOD. It's the amateur hour called Neil Won't Like It. Want to talk? Send your tape. WIOD, 1401 North Bay Causeway, Miami, 33141. Neil Won't Like It. And that's a fact. From News Talk and Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
Okay, 10:26 at WIOD. I'm just getting the fish wrap around here. The Herald, look at this. Still a rat race. They got a big picture on the front page, a big article by Dan LeBastard on there in the front page. And now they got a big thing here, still a rat race with a huge picture of Barrasso down. And there's Mellenby in a crease and the puck. That was the disputed goal. The only thing I don't understand about that, maybe somebody can explain it to me. I've never seen a video review on a goal that took as long as that one did. And, you know, the referee, Terry Gregson, went over there. And then, you know, he's talking to the guy upstairs and they're reviewing it. And then Skrudland went nuts like, yeah, it's a goal. And the crowd went nuts and here come the rats again. And then they're like talking about it again and again and again. And it was, I guess we ran out of rats for the moment. And they said, okay, finally, we got no more rats. It's a goal. Let's go back and play some more. I don't get that. Now, the second one, I heard Rick asking about that. The reason the second goal wasn't the goal is because there was a delayed penalty coming against us and the whistle had already blown, which I think Barrasso heard the whistle and the red light never came on anyway and they had let up play. It really technically stopped, so the penalty. Although a couple of times in the game, Gregson called penalties on us and we had possession of the puck and play kept going on, and that was one of them, and you wondered, how the hell can the penalty be on us because we're in possession of it? But anyway, we're not going to worry about that. So is Greg Kotek's? Oh, here it is. Here it is. Superstar stifling strategy successful. And by the way, Mario Lemieux says we're the best defensive team he's ever played against. How do you like that? So let's see. Okay. Talks about Lemieux and Yager and covering him like a blanket. And does he make any reference to what an asshole he is or not? Are we supposed to forget about that? No. Oh, there's nothing in here about any of that stuff. It's just about Karkner and Svela and Murphy and Mario and this one and Dave Roche and Van Beesbrook and this one. No, nothing in there about Greg Cody and how he tried to pee on our parade. We don't forget it. I'll tell you that. Here's a man who could not get in there last night, and I feel so bad about that.
I could have, but I got too fussy about the tickets that I had.
Shouldn't have been fussy. Should not have been fussy.
I know, not last night. But about that disputed goal.
Yeah.
There was a penalty, obviously, on Pittsburgh.
Delayed penalty.
Now, what happened is Barrasso hit the puck with his stick. It bounced off his defenseman and into the net.
Right.
Now, normally, when they get control of the puck, the whistle blows and it's no goal. But
right.
There's a rule that says that there's two exceptions to that rule. One is if it goes off a goalie stick, and the other one is if it goes off the clothing of the team that's being penalized. And
right.
Actually, both things happened on the same play.
Right.
And therefore, the goal was allowed. And there wasn't a stoppage play.
It was really funny because the rats came out immediately.
Oh,
and then they cleaned those all up. And then they had the big discussion the first time. And then when Skrulin went nuts, even before Gregson pointed to center ice, Skrulin went nuts. And then they threw him out again. And they came out and cleaned him up. And then he came to center ice a third time. And I don't understand what they were arguing about at that point.
And then it was the case of, once they cleared that up, it was a case of whether the goal had gone off the post before or after the goal was scored.
Uh-huh.
And it was very clear on the replay that the puck went in first.
Oh, yeah, you could even see that in the arena on that crappy diamond board we got. You could see that it was close, but the puck was in there, and then immediately the net got dislodged, but it was in before that.
Just tremendous.
It was some night to be there.
So you're flying up tomorrow?
No, we had a chance. Rimmer offered me tickets. I could have had tickets for tomorrow night, but I think with all the stress and the strain and the it'll be a lot easier and better in this case to sit back and watch it on TV,
right.
You know?
Besides,
who the hell wants to go to Pittsburgh?
You're going to relax up the track tonight, or you don't know?
Yeah, track sounds good for tonight, as a matter of fact. I'll make you a deal. I'll be there.
It's in between. You get a chance to take it easy and win some.
Yeah, and make a nice contribution.
There you go.
I'll be there.
See you tonight.
Okay, Rich.
Bye.
Fat Rich there, who could not get in. So if anybody else tried like crazy to get in last night, which I'm sure a lot of you did, if that man couldn't get in there, and the thing of it is, like he said, he could have gotten in, but he was too picky. They gave him some nosebleed seats. He said, no, not for me. Not for me. And now, of course, he regrets it because just being inside the building and being part of that last night was just, there are no words to describe it. You had to be there. And, of course, when Rick Riley, who's, he's learning, he's becoming a fan. But when he can get that psychotic about it as he did, then you know it must have been phenomenal. And it was. It was just like nonstop. It just kept building and building to a gigantic crescendo, and people were like on the edges of their seats and biting their nails. And the great part of it is in that last minute there, after Yager had that one real dangerous chance and we were like biting our fingernails up to our armpits, after that, we did a real good job and we kept clearing it out. And like you heard there with Chris Cuthbert on a replay, in the last 40 seconds or so, they really never had any kind of a shot, and we kept poking it out. When in doubt, poke it out. That's what we're saying about Claude Lemieux's eyes. When in doubt, poke it out. Here's Delray Beach. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
The hockey god.
Yes, I am.
South Florida.
Marty Straka, God.
Oh, my God. I just got to tell you thank you so much. Last November, October, I was on the road for my company, and I listened to you talk. I've been listening to you since the day after you got rid of the bird, by the way.
Oh, congratulations.
And I heard you talking about hockey, and I said, that sounded like a good idea. I took my fiance. We have been addicted. I introduced you to, myself to you, I guess, a week after your birthday. Anyhow, we've been going to games, went to one of the playoff games with the Flyers. I think it was game 5 or 6.
Mm-hmm.
And then have been watching religiously the playoffs, and that game last night was outrageous. I owe it all to you, Neil.
Great.
Never knew what a sport this was, and I'm addicted to it.
And even the coach, I haven't heard from him at all, which I'm kind of shocked and disappointed because I know their plane's leaving at 2 or 2:30 for Pittsburgh, but I would have thought there would have been a telegram here saying thanks for bringing me back to my senses and seeing the light and putting Straka back in there. And did you see his quote in the Sun Sentinel this morning?
Not yet. I have it in my lunch bag. That's what I'm doing for lunch.
It's on one of the inside pages because, needless to say, the articles go on forever. Here's the big thing on a front page. Keep believing in the big picture. And there's, but where the hell? I want to make sure I'm quoting him exactly right because this is kind of a delicate thing. Now I can't find it. He says it's kind of like sticking it up the coach's butt is what Doug MacLean said about because he had kept Straka out of game 5 and he sticks him in there and he scores a gigantic goal and plays phenomenal.
Right.
So I'm kind of paraphrasing, but that's really what he said. It's kind of like sticking it up my butt.
Huh.
And he got upset about my saying that he was in the showers with Straka the other day. He gets pissed off about that. And he's quoting in the newspapers talking about Straka stuck it up his butt. How do you like that, Mr. Sensitive Coach?
He's got a lot on his mind right now, Neil. Give him a break.
Okay.
Hey,
like what?
Yeah, really, exactly.
I gave him the winning formula. Now all he needs is to implement it.
I love it. This is my last day on the current company I'm with. I'm going back on the road, so I will be your faithful listener. I haven't been able to listen to you for the last 4 months.
Well, it's about time you got with it. About time you came to your senses.
Yep, I'm at my desk. Would you put me on hold for a few minutes?
Have a great day, pal.
Thanks.
You see ya. We have an open line on the green line. Hi, Cheryl. Boy, she gets some bad information, by the way. 1-800 spoiled my whole day yesterday. She'll be pleased. Being Jewish, she'll appreciate that, boy. Because, like, no, seriously, call up my mother. She'll give you so many high points. She'll high-five you over the phone and send you 20 cases of Mandelbread.
Oh, he was kvetching all day good. That's what life's all about. Isn't it nice going, Cheryl?
I'm telling you, she'll be very proud of you. I'm going to come in here and slap you in the head in a minute. So anyway, we have an open line on the green line, 1-800-944-9463, 1-800. In fact, when I walked in over there this morning, they looked at me and said, what's not to like? Just like my mother would say, what's not to like? Here's Pembroke Pines. Hello.
Neil, how you feeling?
Phenomenal.
Excellent. I got to hand it to you. I mean, I heard you yesterday talking about put Marty Straka back in there. Get Jason Woolley back in there.
Did that kid play a game last night or what?
Jason Woolley coming up and stopping Lemieux in an open net.
Yep. And, was that some phenomenal blocker, huh? Oh, man, I almost forgot about that play.
From your mouth to Doug MacLean's ears.
To God's ears, right.
Hey, I got a quick question for you. First of all, talking about Wayne Huizenga, did you see the lapel pins he had on? Had a rat hanging, had the big rat.
Oh, yeah, he's been doing that for the last 3 or 4 games.
What
yeah.
a marketing genius.
Yep.
Secondly, the song that they play in the NHL after the goals, Rock and Roll by Gary Glitter.
Right.
Any idea how that came to be hockey tradition? Who started that, where it came from?
I really can't tell you that. Somebody will probably know which arena that started in. But, I mean, one of the things now, for example, in Toronto, they don't play that. They play that Shake Your Body, whatever that thing is called. I don't know. No, they do. Don't you know what I'm talking about?
Know what you're talking about.
Yeah, what's the name of that?
Well, if I... couldn't even tell.
Again, but you're laughing, see, because I don't know what it is either. But that's what they usually play. They have some other stuff, but they play that most of the time when the Leafs score a goal. But one of the things that disturbs me is that, like, at football and hockey games, most of the arenas and the stadiums, they have the same tired song over it, you know, and it gets kind of monotonous.
That song in particular pumps me up, pumps the crowd up. I'm sure it pumps the team up, and enjoy listening to you, Neil.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, take
care.
Have
a great day. Shake Your Body. What is the name of that? What's the name of it, George?
Shake Your Body.
Like I said, that's the name of it. I told you that. By who?
Technotronic.
Oh, yeah, Technotronic. Well, there you go. Now you're talking. What do you expect from an old man like me? Huh? Like I know crap like that? Next, you'll be asking me what were we playing on Zeta. By the way, Pete Bolger did say we're going to be playing a lot of CCR on the show. Rolling. Yeah, a lot of Creedence Clearwater. Hey, it'll fit right in. So anyway, well, they're old, too. 1035 at WIOD.
When you talk live on 610 WIOD, you'll be recorded, and we'll play the tape back whenever we feel like it.
It's Friday, you bastard.
Being gay in the world today takes everything you've got. Now you want to be legally married just because you squat. Wouldn't you like to get away?
Okay.
Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows you're gay. I hear that Key West is okay.
Oi!
You want to be down on your knees, your salad tossing gourmet. You want to go where everybody knows you're gay.
Okay.
Gay in the world today, I think, is really nuts. Your lifestyle makes you smile. You like big hairy butts. But don't you hate those starchy stains?
Yes!
Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows you're gay. I think that lesbians are great. A kiss on the lips right by your hips from a girlfriend seems okay. You wanna go where everybody knows you're gay. You wanna bend for your best friend, put icing on his cake. You wanna go where everybody knows you're gay.
Okay.
There's a dream that lives deep in every heart. Heroes call their name, legends leave their mark. And it's worth the sweat, and it's worth the pain. 'Cause the chance may never come again.
10:45 to go in the third period. Played by Gord Murphy, back out. Then Straka hustling again. Great move by Straka. Bill Lindsay, then Straka scores!
Okay, 1042 at WIOD. Only one negative. I don't want to pee on our parade either, but I will say this, that some of you people out there, just a small handful, some of you just don't know how to behave, okay? During the national anthem is not the time to be throwing rats or any other crap on the ice. And then later on in the game, you know, when the goals are scored, nobody loves the rats more than I do. But other times, like when you start delaying the game and you make us look like a bunch of fools nationwide, coast to coast, all over North America, and God, I don't know, probably all over the world it's on right now, Who the hell needs that? You know, those people that just keep heaving stuff because, you know, they're all wrapped up or they're drunk or should be wrapped up, get them out of there. Here's somebody we're trying to get out of our lives.
Anyway, two perfect leads.
Boy, are you chronic lately?
Oh, it's terrible. Listen,
since you got that gallbladder fixed.
I know exactly what MacLean said. It was incredible.
Yeah.
He said he stuck it up my ass. I like when they do that. I wish they'd do that more often.
Is that what he said?
That was very exact.
Well, you're banned from the arena now. You're done. You're out.
Those are the exact words.
Yeah, right.
I swear.
That's what he said.
I swear to God.
That's what the coach of the Florida. And, you know, I heard.
He said it laughingly, and the whole place just cracked up. You can hear all the reports.
I heard through the grapevine that he was a little bit, and him and his wife were a little upset that I made some joke yesterday about him shower. Straka wouldn't let him shower in the stall next to him.
Don't believe it unless you hear it from him.
And he's all bent out of shape about that. And now, yeah, that's right. I hear it secondhand from that prude Rimmer. You know what a prude he is. He's so uptight about life in general.
Oh, man, I'll tell you
but
what.
But I'd be uptight, too, if I had to go do arena football while the Panthers are playing Game 7 in Pittsburgh tomorrow night and not even be able to watch it on television.
Oh, my
Boy.
God. I've got my baby shower tomorrow night at 7 o'clock.
And you're going to your baby shower? Why don't you just put the baby in a bathtub and just, you know.
Not even born yet.
Just put the hot water in there. You know, that's, or how about it like in a paper, it's not even born yet and you're having a baby shower. How the hell can you do that?
The only good thing is I won't have to watch it on my TV with the 1 foot crack in it with the 2 inch black stripe going up and down.
Oh, still don't have it fixed yet, huh?
Andy, you better give me a call, damn it. I want my frickin' screen.
Oh,
anyway,
man.
Listen, one thing I noticed, women really get into the sport. My wife couldn't give a crap about the Dolphins or Marino or anything else. But let me tell you what, she was going absolutely apeshit. I thought we could put the baby right there on the carpet in front of the TV.
Really? Wouldn't that have been something? You could have named it Puckface. Yeah, well, it would have been perfect, wouldn't it? Puckface. I'm sure you've been called that often in your life or something that sounds like that.
Similar to that, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, you pegged it, Coach.
Yeah.
You pegged the line.
How'd you like that line last night, huh? Three of the four goals. First we had Mellenby, then we had Strachan and Robbie Niedermeyer, who's awakened out of that slumber, man. They were just dynamite all night long.
Listen, all that could
and
think,
not just and not just the goals that they scored, but how'd
no,
you like and you notice when we had the 4-on-4 a couple of times, which I don't like 4-on-4 against the Penguins because they're fast, they're dangerous. Do you notice who he put out there 4-on-4? He put out Straka and Niedermeyer, our two fastest guys.
Was Joe playing less last night?
Was what?
Jovo playing a lot less last night.
Well, we had seven defensemen dressed, plus you didn't see him that much because he didn't make any mistakes. He played a solid game.
Yeah.
He just didn't make any mistakes, thank God.
Skrudlin is incredible.
Toward the end, Warner and Murphy were both had a case of cough-up disease, and I was just puking in that towel. I was having a nervous breakdown.
Did you see Skrudlin hit Lemieux in the face?
No, I didn't see that.
Oh, that was terrible.
Yeah. And also, you know, then he put Skrulin and Huff out there on the 4-on-4, and I thought, oh, boy, we got a couple of slow guys. But they played dynamite.
Yeah.
They were forechecking. They kept it in their end the whole time. Yeah, I did see what he did to Lemieux.
Oh, terrible, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Anyway.
Too bad.
In closing, I've got one thing to say for tomorrow night.
Yes?
No changes, Coach.
All right. Have a good
day.
We have an open line on the green line. It's in Palm Beach, 1-800-944-9463, 1-800-944-WIOD. This town is pumped up, okay? Listen, I didn't even give you a score yesterday. I kind of mumbled 6-2, which is nowhere even close. But I knew we were going to win. I was confident. I had a good feeling about that game last night, legitimately and honestly. There were times during the game I didn't have such a good feeling about it, like early in the second period when we were in a coma, and then after they tied it up there on it. I'll tell you one thing about Mario Lemieux, man. Just when you figure he's not doing much and we got him all tied up and he makes that incredible play, and they try to anticipate his moves, and all of a sudden he's skating around this one, he's skating around another guy, he's skating around three guys, and he makes a lovely little pass, as Harry Neal would say, to the open guy, Sandstrom, all alone, no chance for the Beezer, and it's tied up faster than you can say douchebag. But we come right back, and Niedermeyer stuck that one in there, and that place erupted and went crazy. And the last 6 minutes, with the exception of the Jager chance, which was, gut-wrenching, with the exception of that, they really never had too many chances there in the last 6 minutes, thank the Lord, and we did it. We did it, and everybody was on their feet at the end. There was nobody who left early. Everybody was having a parade. They were partying in their pants. It was dynamite. It's what I've been telling you for years now, and they're finally catching on, okay? I've been telling you about the good stuff, and they're finally catching on to it. Better late than ever. 1047 at WIOD. It's madness at Kendall Toyota. By the way, speaking of Kendall Toyota, who's at the game last night? Mark Jacobson's there.
Oi!
That's right. Haven't seen him at a game in who knows how long. Has he been at any games? But now that it's big stuff, there is Mark Jacobson there. He don't want to miss off out on the bandwagon.
Then, this Tuesday night at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, it's game one of the Stanley Cup Finals.
Big shot!
As the champions of the Eastern and Western Conferences face off. And don't miss Fox Tracks, the glowing electronic puck. Remember, baseball on Fox premieres Saturday.
Unbelievable!
When the Braves face the Reds.
Catch Fox Saturday Baseball tomorrow at 12:30 on WSVN 7 Fox.
South Florida's news.
His mother said that she was boiling water to wash clothes. This is what she does routinely, and that's when the child stuck his hand in the water.
From South Florida's premier news team.
We can expect some strong thunderstorms, and, you know, with any strong thunderstorm, there's always a possibility to get some funnel clouds or even a tornado.
The best news. News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
Neil God.
Neil God.
Neil God?
Okay, 10:53 at WIOD. Here's a fax that says, you know that Brian Smolinski is a Spartan, but so are the Penguins' Kevin Miller and the Panthers' defenseman Jason Woolley.
Oh!
Can we get an all right for Jason's fine goal-saving shot block when Beezer was out of position in the game last night? I think Mandich can do it.
All right!
There you go. It's the least he can do, Mr. Hotshot. Anyway, it's 10:53 at WIOD. A lot of people are changing their tune now all of a sudden because, like I said, it comes down to one game. And even if they beat us tomorrow night 100-0, which they won't, but even if they did, can it really spoil our parade right now? I don't think so, because now it's all anticlimactic. We're five wins away from the Stanley Cup. Do I think we match up well against Colorado? No. But did I think we matched up well against Philadelphia? Not really. Did I think we matched up well against the Penguins? Hardly. So what difference does it make? Because like I said, when you got balls the size of watermelons, it doesn't really make any difference. And every one of those guys on his team, I don't even know how these guys walk around. In fact, I wondered why Jody was walking so strange when he came up to say hi the other night at the arena. When you're hung like a moose, when you got the elephant size, it's pretty hard to walk around without dragging a little bit. Here's a Liberty City. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Phenomenal.
Unbelievable.
Yes.
Give me
unbelievable.
The first and third period of last night. Marty Straka playing that serious offense with Bill Lindsay playing a great game.
Right.
Defense by Jason Moore. That guy took the puck full in the stomach.
Right.
That's defense.
Oh, that was a great block, boy. That was like the guy said in his facts, that was a game saver right there.
If we can play like just the first and third periods, forget the second period, that wasn't so great, but the first and third periods.
Well, yeah, but you know what you're forgetting? Even though they outscored us 2-1 in the second period, like I said, after they got the first 9 shots in a row, and one of them was Kevin Miller's goal that tied it up at that point, but we outshot them 16-1 or something in the rest of that period.
Yeah, Barrasso,
I mean, we really came back on like wildfire.
Yeah, Barrasso was earning his paycheck.
Yeah.
No doubt.
One thing that we learned is that we can't take a little time off in any of these games, especially Saturday. We got to play 3 full solid periods and concentrate, which isn't easy to do, but we can't afford to take a few minutes off.
Yeah, you can't give Yager those breakaways.
Right.
You can't let Mario inside like that. These are still the two best players in the game.
But that damn Sam Jagr, man. Every time he gets the puck in the corner, especially, and he just keeps getting away from guys and gets in. Oh, yeah, they got two guys on him to try to get the puck away, and he just keeps digging, and with one arm, he's stronger than most guys with two arms, and he keeps spinning these guys around in circles and making moves, and they come out of there, and he's got the puck. He's just unbelievable.
He's got those little tight moves. His arm will move inches.
Yeah.
The puck just takes off from
right.
His stick. I don't know how he does it.
Yeah, he's phenomenal.
He's something else. I wish I had a satellite dish like you do. ESPN, the worst. That first goal, that Mellenby goal.
Yeah.
It was the second or third period before they figured out what the hell was going on. They had no idea. I mean, they had a crappy camera angle, so you actually couldn't tell if Mellenby or the puck went in.
Oh, CBC had it perfect, as usual. They were right on top of it.
Because the Canucks know hockey.
They know they're crap.
That's the official religion up there.
Right.
ESPN has a bad camera angle, so they're going on about that. They're talking about the penalty, and it's obvious no one had control of the puck.
Right.
On the delayed whistle.
So, right.
So we're wondering whether, you know, the puck went in first or Mellenby. And then finally, after 10 minutes, 15 minutes, they finally show the other camera angle. You can see, yes, the puck went in first, absolutely.
Geez, I don't know why they had so much trouble, because on that part of the dispute, you could see it, like I told Rich, you could see right on the diamond board up there, the diamond division right inside the arena, you could see that.
Because even
puck
the
puck goes in, the net comes off.
Even the idiots that work at the arena, I mean, they've worked enough games, they know how to see what's going on, but ESPN hasn't got it figured out yet.
Yeah, well, they're too busy putting us down. They're too busy talking crap.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. Melrose, I just can't take him anymore. Idiot. But, hey, we persevere.
Okay.
More power to him. Go Panthers.
See you, pal.
Bye-bye.
Open line of day, it's 751-9463. Like I've told you before, we're not going to orchestrate things for the convenience of ESPN or Schlocks or anybody else. We're just going to go out there and keep winning games. That's all, and be very happy about it and very psyched. We'll have a big, gigantic parade here, and everybody's peeing all over each other and high-fiving and low-fiving and going nuts. And like I said, the only negative thing is some of the people with the rats, you know, there's a time and a place. Learn the time. It's not a question of if you're going to throw them. It's a question of when. That's what I was thinking myself this morning. It's not a question of if. Okay, let's do Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Good morning, Neil.
Yes, sir.
I've been to a lot of sporting events, and I think last night's game was one of the best sporting events I've ever attended by fan-wise, excitement, hockey, fabulous.
Absolutely.
It was. It was absolutely fabulous. And, you know, it was funny. I think the ref might have had a problem with the phone on the Mellenby goal because he was looking up at the box where the guys are, and he was doing hand signals. And
he kept getting disconnected.
Yeah, I think that's what it was. I think they had a problem with the phone.
Oh, I know that.
And so I had my rat, and I kind of half throw it, and then I'd hold it back, and I half throw it, and then I hold it back,
yeah.
You know, that type of thing.
Yeah, that was because when Skrudlin went ape shot there, I thought, okay, and I was screaming and yelling, and then they kept going back over there. I've never seen that before.
Yeah, neither I. And what about before the game started when Stanley C. Panther attacked the Penguin?
That was beautiful.
Wasn't that beautiful?
I loved it.
Listen, I called up Ticketmaster in Pittsburgh this morning at 9 o'clock, and I got two tickets for the game up there. I'm flying up tomorrow
morning.
I'm serious. There were two single... I called up and asked him if there were any seats together. He had single seats only. I got two single seats in two separate sections. But, hey, I'll go up there, and I'll go and sit in my section. Whatever ticket's better. If I can't get anyone to go with me, I'll just go ahead and sell the other ticket.
There you
go. I got two tickets through Ticketmaster. I got the number. I called up. I got two tickets.
Hey, listen, I guess it's easier getting them for up there than it is down here.
Yeah, you know, and there were no two seats together, but they had single seats available.
That's Pittsburgh for you. That's those great fans, man. They got a hell of a team, but the fans, a lot of games during the regular season, even against good opposition, you see empty seats up there.
Yeah, no, I mean, it was no problem. The guy goes, yeah, I got a single seat here, and then I could only do one transaction at a time. I couldn't get two. I had to do, like, one ticket, pay for it, and then another ticket. And I thought, by the time the first transaction goes through, I'll never be able to get the second seat.
Right.
But it was still available.
Beauty. Okay, pal, have a great time.
All right, thanks, Neil. Bye.
See ya. An excellent thing, a beautiful thing. I bet you we got a bunch of people going up. We have an open line in Broward. Of course, I know somebody that's going to be doing arena football while the game is going on. But, hey, you know, it's just one of those things. We all got to eat. You know what I'm saying? We got to do what we got to do.
Let's get this crap settled. It's a game. Let's play hockey. WIOD, Miami, Fort Lauderdale. News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
Good morning. At 11 o'clock, I'm Terry Griffin with 610 WIOD News.
O'Neal, my queen. God.
Craving big dill pics.
Kind of a frightening thought that she's reproducing, but what the hell, it's not all that hard, so to speak. That's what he said. It's 11:06 at WIOD. Happy Friday. Boy, what a weekend this is going to be, huh? What a weekend this is going to be. Before those guys get on a plane, by the way, they should all know that win or lose, we love each and every one of them. Some of them a little more than others, but hey, they can't all look that good. But and even the coach, okay, I'll overlook some of the stuff, the fact that he tried to show how much smarter he was than I am. We all know that's not true. Just ask Brian Murray, man. He'll tell you.
You're not eating those pastries that were out in the hallway, are you?
Yes, I am.
Pig.
Why? It's like...
I'm calling Dr. Atkins right now.
It's like banana bread or something like... Well, it was sitting there, okay? Bread. Yeah, banana bread. Not real bread, but banana bread, which is probably even worse because it's got sugar
right.
in it. And it's really good, too, by the way, and I think there's one more piece, and I'm going to eat it, whether you like it or not, Smarty Pants. In fact, that's one thing I told the Paxson people this morning. I said, George is okay, but he's the nosiest bastard.
Yeah, and...
Here's Boca. Hello.
Hey, Neil. How you doing?
And they said, well, you know how those picks are. I said, yeah, that's true. Okay.
How you doing? I just want to reiterate, I was at the game last night, and I have to say I've been to sporting events for 30 years, and that was the greatest sporting event I've ever been to.
Amen.
I think that the crowd willed them to win in the third period. The noise level kept getting larger, and you could just sense the energy they were reflecting down on the ice.
You'll be pleased to know that when the game started on the CBC, because I got my tape at home, and Chris Kutzber came on and said to John Garrett, he said, we've talked about how loud it's been in here every night all through the playoffs, but he said, I don't think it's ever been as loud as this. And that was in the beginning, and it just kept getting louder from there.
One player I really have to give some laudits to, and that's Bill Lindsay.
Right.
I think... If you notice, in the second period, they were leading 2-1. If they got another goal,
that's right. That,
the game would have been over.
I said before, maybe you didn't hear it, I said that was the turning point of the entire
Absolutely.
Game.
And you got to look at what he has done. He scored the game winner in against Boston the sixth game.
Right.
In Philadelphia in the sixth game, he was the one who picked up the loose puck, came in on a breakaway, and
right.
started the route in the sixth game in Philadelphia.
Right.
I think he's the money player on the team. And look what he did when he fed the pass back to Straka.
Exactly.
But if you watched Straka last night from the get-go, he was on fire.
Yep.
And I just hope MacLean keeps Jason Woolley and him in the lineup.
I agree.
But I got to say, when I walked out of the arena, the consensus was that it didn't matter what happened Linton Saturday, because for the Panthers to win it in front of their fans...
Right. It's like we already won a Stanley Cup.
Right. I think they've done it. And I think, like I say, I just want to make sure people understand there is nothing better than what this team has done in South Florida history.
Right.
Thank you. Goodbye.
All right. We have an open line on the green line. He said it extremely well, and he's absolutely right. And if this sounds a little bit syrupy today, too bad. We don't care. If you don't want to be part of our party like that bitch that called yesterday, huh?
Oh, is that all you're going to talk about is hockey now during these playoffs?
Yeah, that's right. If you got something else important you want to talk about, sweetheart, lay it on the table, sweetheart. Get it out, lay it right here on the table, and let's sink our teeth into it. What is it? She didn't have nothing else to talk about, and she admits that she's listened every day, and she's listening right now. And she's probably even pretending, oh, yeah, that's right, this is pretty good, you know what? Yeah, right. Because when it turns out that you're winners, when it turns out that it's something really exciting and positive, then people that don't even know what you're talking about say, oh, yeah, that's pretty good stuff. What is it? How do they play that? But that's what people are like. They want something they can grab onto that's good. All my life, I've always felt that way. If I can find something good to grab onto, let me have it. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh, God.
Exactly. Here's a lady in Fort Lauderdale, which I bet it's not that one. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
How you doing?
Great. I want to take some credit for their win yesterday.
Okay.
Because I didn't watch it on TV. I've never seen them win on TV, so I paced for 3 hours. And I just want to tell you this.
You did what?
I paced for 3 hours. I've never been able to watch him win on TV, so I figure that I'm bad luck.
And you listened to it on a radio?
No, I didn't do anything. I paced in front of a blank screen. But listen to this. Listen to this,
though. And you think you got mental problems, folks.
No, listen to this.
Yeah.
So I'm talking to this old lady in another state, and she's flipping the channels, and she goes, oh, my God, how disgusting. I said, what? She goes, there's rats all over the ground somewhere. I said, oh, my God. I said, that means they must have scored.
There you go.
Yeah, so that's it.
She probably never heard that expression before anyway, scored.
Yeah, probably not. All right, have a great day.
Well, thanks a lot, sweetheart. We appreciate it.
Take care.
Okay.
Bye.
She was pacing it. She was trotting and pacing and squatting and back and forth in front of a blank screen. I bet you Paul Harvey Jr. could be doing the same thing, too, with that set that he busted the other night, pacing in front of a blank screen for about $500. Yeah, there's rats on the ice. Oh, yeah, look how disgusting that is. Yeah, I don't think so. I think everybody's realizes that we came up with something uniquely ours, okay? Uniquely ours. And, of course, over there in that neighborhood, it fits in like a glove. It's perfect. Rats. Some with two legs, some with four legs, some with no legs. Here's Hialeah.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Phenomenal.
Outrageous.
The best.
The best. Listen, let me give you an insight of what happened last night on the Mullenby Gull. Okay, what happened was that...
You mean Fat Rich got it wrong?
Yeah, Fat Rich is very wrong. Because I heard this from Mellonby on your sister station, Zeta, this morning.
Mm-hmm.
He said that what the goal was...
By the way, I was over there this morning, and Omelette came running out in the hallway and kissed me right on the lips. What does that mean?
I don't know, but did you touch his lucky butt?
No, I did not.
Oh, okay, then...
But I might.
You missed out. Okay, well, the thing was that the goal was good. They didn't, the bench didn't even, you know, had no controversy about that.
Yeah.
And, of course, the penalty was nullified because the goal was good.
Mm-hmm.
But there was an earlier penalty up ice, and that's what, you know,
right.
Doug wanted.
He that's said right.
He wanted that penalty to stand.
Right.
And they were, you know, that was the controversy. He said, I want that penalty to stand. And, you know, they said, well, no. And so we just took the goal and just kept on skating. So that's the true story, and
yeah.
That's from Mellonby's mouth. And by the way, he's a
you're
class
you're
act.
Right, because in the midst of the excitement, I forgot about all that, but there was a second penalty. You're right.
What?
Right.
Yeah.
Like I said.
Yeah. Go Panthers.
Okay. Yeah, Fat Rich was right. No, there was another penalty. There was an additional penalty that he was going to call, but it was a delayed penalty coming up, but because we scored the goal, that would have been wiped out, so I don't know what he's talking about. You had it like, when I have time in the leisure of the privacy of my little room there, I'll wind the tape back, and I'll figure it out. In the meantime, who cares? It's like some of the people at the game last night are going, well, how come this? Well, we got the goal. What difference does it make? You know, we got the goal. What are you having a big song and a dance about it? Take it and smile and be happy. Some of them are writing a book, I guess. It's called I Was a Putz. 11:13 at WIOD. You're up.
Good hockey club, you know, as far as I'm concerned, all the guys, you know, we pitch in and take care of each other's babies, and all the wives go shopping, and we diaper each other, you know, and the kids get loose in the street. It's great playing for the team.
Phil Hendry, 2 to 6 p.m. on News, Talk, and Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
This is the most disgusting program. I urge everyone to complain to this station.
I'm real horny. My Marine boyfriend's out killing in another country. What should I do?
Sergeant Dildo reporting for duty, ma'am.
Sergeant Dildo?
Sergeant Dildo, the soldier that digs deep in the bush. He'll fill your foxhole with love. He'll blow you away. Just strap on his helmet, add two D batteries, and switch him on.
But get to the nerve center.
Oh, yeah. Right
that.
There.
Oh, yes, Sergeant Dildo. Oh.
Sergeant Dildo at all adult bookstores and Army surplus outlets.
So, by the way, we heard from Sally lately or what? It's 11:47 at WIOD. What is it? What?
The monitor.
The monitor
how's it
what?
Doing?
Not good. Why? It's going to, like, fix itself like spontaneous emission or something? I think some people may have had some of those at the game last night, but I don't think the monitor is going to, like, fix itself. No, it's still, in fact, it's just the only moments before you walked in there, Mitch, it cut out again. And I, like, but as soon as you turn the mic switch on, so that's good. Just keep popping a mic switch on. Like, when somebody walks in the room and opens up a big mouth, just pop on a mic switch. Say, oh, if you want to hear the monitor, and by the way, we're on here, and you hear what you just said? That began with an F? And I think it was the same thing J.D. said on the game last Sunday. Here's Miami on a purple line. Hello? Miami on a purple line is gone? That we pay for on the AT&T and on the other one?
No, I'm here.
Oh, thank God.
Man, I had you on hold.
That would be depressing.
Neil, do you know Lemieux was quoted at a Pittsburgh paper as saying the Panthers are the toughest
the best defensive team he's ever played against in his life. How do you like that?
Can you believe
which
that?
Covers quite a bit of territory.
Yes, sir. And why don't they play that song at the arena? That, you know, the dream may never come again? Or
I suggested that. I told him that because there's a great video that goes along with that from CBC. It's phenomenal, and it's got all the clips from the you know, the different series ongoing in the playoffs, including Panthers and Penguins and Red Wings and whatever. And the guy from CBC, John Shannon, said, well, we don't want to offend the Penguins. I don't know why I would offend them because they're featured in there too, Mario and Yager and Barrasso. Right. It would have been a great idea, but it was my idea, so they're not going to do it. It would have been phenomenal. The place would have gone nuts.
I get goosebumps driving down US 1 listening to it.
I know it. I'm going to keep working on it, maybe for the Avalanche series.
There you go.
Looked Finals.
Like, looked like you might have caught an elbow in the face yesterday. You didn't take a towel out of your mouth.
I know it.
Looked tough.
I know it. I just, hey, thank God for that towel, man. I was biting it and squeezing it and clenching it and the towel, too.
All right, partner.
Thanks
Cheer
a lot, pal.
In Pittsburgh.
Huh?
Cheer him on in Pittsburgh.
All right.
Hey, Mark Jacobs, he ought to go into politics. I saw him walking around the arena all night.
Yeah.
Just politics.
Mr. Slick, huh?
He wasn't there for the game. He was. I don't know what he was building.
They don't come any slicker or slimier than my buddy Mark. Okay, pal.
Go Panthers.
Have a great day. Go Panthers. So anyway, yeah, they're all in the bandwagon now, and Greg Kotex has got the unmitigated gallstones to write an article in the Herald this morning, and there's nothing even mentioned there, like we have Alzheimer's, like we forgot about the fact that last night was supposed to be the last game, and we lose. That's what he said. Oh, yeah, we were supposed to be all depressed, like the guy, remember the guy the other day says to me, I'm supposed to be depressed and angry, not just depressed, but angry because we lost that game in Pittsburgh. I wasn't depressed, and I wasn't angry. The only thing I'm depressed and angry about today is that yesterday somebody ruined a whole day of my life, and today they're running around a building laughing about it in kind of a jappy way. That's all right. She'll get hers. She'll get hers. Don't worry about that. Let's go to Plantation. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
This is Coach Neal.
Coach Neal, you got him.
How you doing? Are you getting part of the coach's salary?
Yes, I am, as a matter of fact. 50%.
Great call yesterday on Strock and Woolley.
How about that?
That was a great save Woolley made.
Woolley
you know?
Made the save of the night. Even the Beezer never made one as good as that last night. And then, of course, Straka sticks in the goal and played phenomenal all night long. And he really sparked that Niedermeyer and Mellenby line. And he's dynamite.
Neil, I was wondering, did you read the article in the local section of the Fort Lauderdale paper about this tax-free thing to do with the arena?
Right.
Now?
Nice going, Wayne. Attaboy. Anything Wayne wants now. It's okay with me.
Do you think that'll cause any problems with
the
county?
Nah, it's a done deal. Don't worry about it. I talked to some people about it again yesterday. It's a done deal. It's all set. It's in the, just write it in Braille.
And let me ask you a question about that frog, Lemieux. What's his name? Not Lemieux.
Claude.
Claude, yeah. Claude the frog. He's probably one of the dirtiest players in the league, I take it.
Yes.
But when it comes down to taking off the gloves, is he as tough as he is dirty?
Not really. In fact, I don't see him fight that much, to be honest with you. He's a good cheap shot artist. He's kind of like Ulf Samuelson on the Rangers, formerly of the Penguins. Good cheap shot artist, but when it comes to fighting, you know, he knows how to run fast.
He's a hit-and-run man.
Yeah, he wears the visor and he runs fast.
Can I make a shameless request?
Yes, sir.
You have a tape, the John Bobbitt, the Vegematic thing.
Right.
Think you can play that, please?
I might dig it out.
Okay, thank you, Neil.
So to speak.
Okay.
Have a great day, pal.
Okay, you too. Okay, bye-bye.
I think he got all worked up by that dildo thing we had. So anyway, it's 11:21. I think that started it. You know, you start with one small one, and before you know it, it's 11:21 at WIOD.
News, talk, and entertainment radio, 610 WIOD.
It was the greatest TV offer ever, the fabulous Ronco Vegematic. And now, attention ladies, in the labor-saving tradition of the Vegematic, Bobbitt Co. presents the all-new Badge-O-Matic. Badge-O-Matic, the first feminine hygiene product that offers more than just feminine protection. Here's how it works. Your husband Earl is an abusive alcoholic loser, and he's come home again late on a Saturday night.
Hey, baby, it's me, and I'm ready to party.
Actually, dear, I'm rather tired. I'm going to sleep. You're drunk, and I don't want you to touch me.
Earl doesn't know it, but she's inserted her brand-new Vagimatic feminine protection device.
Hey, let's boogie, baby. Ready or not, here comes Earl.
Earl, I must warn you, I'm wearing my new Vagimatic, so please leave me alone.
Vagimatic sounds kinky, baby. Let's do it.
I'm warning you, don't do that.
Oh, my God! Help me! I'm bleeding! Hey,
My d*** gone.
Sorry, honey. When I said no, I meant no.
Give me back my d***.
I don't think so. The Vagmatic slices and dices and a puree.
No, no, not puree.
They won't be able to sew that back on. It's Vagmatic. Real feminine protection from Bobbit Co.
What are you going to do with my d***, honey?
I'm making sausages. Here, Fido.
Oh, no, not sausages.
Vagmatic. Pitch the Ginsu knives. Throw out your machete and try a Vagmatic. It slices, it snips, it mutilates, and it's beltless. And it even makes julienne fries.
No, no, not julienne fries.
Vagmatic from Bobbit Co. Call now and receive a free pocket fisherman and our handy home suture kit.
Hi, I'm Lorena Bobbit, and when it comes to feminine protection, nothing cuts the mustard like a Vagmatic.
Vagmatic. Order now. Call 1-800-866-7426. That's 1-800-86-ORGAN.
Okay, and if you're going to send one of those as a gift by mail, like for Daddy's Day, be sure and put a nice bow on it.
I had to fucking wrap it up, you know
exactly.
What I'm saying?
So anyway, 27 past 11 at WIOD on a great Friday. Everybody's in a real partying mood here. Everybody is foaming at the mouth and jumping up and down and apoplectic. Here's Tamarack. Hello.
Speaking of Father's Day.
Yes, sir.
This is STEM.
Chronic.
Well, Chronic got 2 days off this week.
Oh, so you were there last night, huh?
No, I wasn't.
Oh, because I noticed that you and your wife, neither one came by and said hello.
We were a little bit busy.
Had the baby?
Had the baby.
Well, isn't that amazing?
She wouldn't let me go to the game. She insisted I couldn't go. And I said, honey, I'm going no matter what, because she didn't feel real well. And said, well, I'm going to have the baby then. And so...
Just out of spite.
Had the baby yesterday at about 6 o'clock last night. So, and of course, we're at a hospital. It doesn't have cable TV, so I was stuck yet again.
Oh, beautiful.
Listening to QAM.
There's nothing worse for a little kid than being born to a father that hates it already before it's even popped out.
I can't hate her, but... So my buddy, I gave the ticket to my next door neighbor, so he's happy as a lark.
Great.
Got me the ticket, so I've got a
Well,
program.
You sure missed a great game, Sten.
That's
Too
what
bad
I
you
hear.
Couldn't have been there. Too bad your wife was giving birth to some pain-in-the-ass baby.
That's what I hear, but I wanted to call you and let you know. And this way, George and Bob from Cooper City and Dean and Fred will all know.
And, I know and Harlan.
About that, but, you know.
And Harlan.
And Harlan. Well, I don't talk to Harlan anymore, but if he's listening.
Why not?
I don't know. Just can't find him again.
Well, there you go.
But, so yeah, I just want to let you know. Well, you know, I missed the game again. And now the wife, she wants to stay in the hospital till tomorrow night at 11 o'clock. I says, well, you can do what you want, but I'm going home to watch the game.
There you go. Now you're talking. You finally wised up.
I'll have to wait and get the Stanley Cup tickets.
And you won't have to worry about any pain in the ass interruptions.
When's the first game? Next Tuesday night?
Tuesday night.
Well, I'll be there for that.
In Denver.
Tuesday, Thursday, probably Saturday or Sunday?
Huh?
In the arena?
Let's see. Tuesday and Thursday, Saturday and whenever.
Okay, we'll be there Saturday in the arena.
Okay.
Hey.
See you, Stan. Congratulations.
Go Panthers.
Congratulations.
Neil God.
Bye-bye. Open line and a green line. They're reproducing. 1-800-944-9463. 1-800-944-WIOD. Yeah, get over there to the Paxson Complex in the North Dade this morning over there by TCI. And there was Pete Bolger and there was Mitch Lewis was there. And you'll never guess, you know, it was kind of embarrassing because Mitch Lewis saw me and guess what he pressed right up against the window?
Rectum.
Yeah, it was something like that. And then there was an omelet running around in the hallway saying, oh, boy, you see Paul's numbers? You see Paul's numbers? Get out of here. And on the AM side at INZ, there was John McLaughlin, who used to be Bill Calder's producer, who's gotten old and gray. And who else was it? Lori Shepherd was there. And Wendy Harmon was there from accounting. Oh, those accounting people. The station can go through ownership changes 1,000 times, but it's always the same accounting type people because they know where the bodies are buried. They know where all the loose change is. They know how to feel the change. They're all there. Wendy was there. Wendy Harmon, by the way, I gave away a little dog when I was at INZ. I'm trying to think of whose dog it was or where we found it or what that was all about. But I remember I had a little puppy. Maybe somebody gave it to me. And in fact, I should have asked Wendy if she'd like a nice miniature pincher. God, I forgot to ask her that. Here's Boca. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Since you're more of the hockey station than QAM, I need to find out if you can put out a bulletin what the itinerary is for them coming back, if they are, because I heard they packed for a week when they're leaving. The Panthers?
What do you mean by that, for a
week?
Well,
they took it close for a week, because I guess if they win, they're going to go straight to Denver from what... That's what
well, I see what you're saying, yeah. Right.
So, we want to be there at the airport, whatever happens. I mean, if they're not coming, I want to find out. You know, I want to find out the real scoop, because if they come home at all, we want to be there. And if they come home which they won't, losers.
Okay, we'll work on that.
All right, just put out a bulletin.
We'll get all the stuff for you.
Thanks.
Okay. Andy Kalb is in there. Now, don't trust him, okay, because we're not sure about him. His name was not... Okay. And I see Steve Nichol just came back in the building. How's Steve doing? Huh? Was he smiling? Was he crying? Was he like... Oh, he's drinking. Well, it's almost noon, for Christ's sakes. We have an open line on the green line, 1-800-944-9463, 1-800-944-WIOD. I think we ought to have a Panthers party here today, don't you? I think we ought to have some food in this joint and have a big, massive celebration and party all over the goddamn place in honor of last night's massive win.
Oh!
Don't you think so? And in honor of our great meetings that we had this morning, George, but that's only for us. But hey, we can be selfish. Why not?
They love you.
Here's a lady in Miami. Hello.
Florida Panthers. The cup will be ours, and that is not even bragging. It's no deception. Go Panthers, we'll cheer. Come on, jump on the bandwagon. Why don't you? Whether we win, whether we lose, Panthers, Florida loves you. And when those chumps start to yell and the Panthers are wimps, we'll cheer harder and harder. They'll tell us, do what they will, you'll never win. Panthers, run to your mothers. We'll stick together and stick 'em to them. 'Cause one goal leads to another. That's right, 'cause one goal leads to another. God, I'm all flat now.
Oh! Yeah, you were doing so good. You were rolling.
I got so nervous.
That was great.
I love you, and I'm having a party at my home tomorrow night.
Great.
And I'm so excited.
Might as well keep going. You know, it's so much fun now. We might as well just keep rolling right along.
But I'm going to do this to music, and I'm going to send it to you.
All right.
Hey, just for my effort, could you kind of dig up this really hilarious thing that I heard once on your thing, and I haven't heard it for ages?
Yeah.
It's a phone call that somebody's making to a lady, and then you hear the stupidest, most ignorant laughter in the background. Do you know the one I'm talking about?
No.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. If anybody,
what are they talking about?
I don't even remember, because the laugh that I hear in the background is so funny by itself. Do you have any idea what I'm talking about?
No, not even remotely.
I mean...
Sounds like a Jerky Boys thing.
Oh, my goodness. It is... I know that you've played it before. There's no doubt about it. And if anybody out there has heard this and knows what I'm talking about, please let them know what it is. Let you know what it is.
I thought you were going to talk about the guy that calls up the wife and says he had to fire the husband.
Oh, no, that's a good one, too. I love that. No, this is one that has, like, I mean, even Rick and Suds play that laugh, only the laugh part of it.
Yeah.
But it's a full conversation. And
are you sure it's something I play? Maybe it's one of their things.
No, I'm pretty sure I heard it on you.
Okay, well, maybe somebody will know.
Okay.
Okay, sweetheart.
Thanks. Bye.
Nice job.
All right.
We love you, Panthers. Oh, yes, we do. The way you skate and score and follow through.
Oh!
Bring on Yager and Lemieux. Oh, Panthers, we love you.
Oh!
We love you, Scrudland. Oh, yes, we do.
Yes!
Even when you took that double two.
Oh!
For slicing Brindamore clean through. Oh, Screwy, we love you.
Oh!
We love you, Mallinby. You're where it's at. You made the season year of the rat. You are my very favorite cat. Scott Mallinby, where it's at.
Yes!
We love you, Niedermeyer. You've really bloomed. Like a flower in a sunny room.
Oh!
You're gonna score again real soon. Rob Niedermeyer, we love you.
Squirt.
We love you, Beezer. Oh, yes, we do. With your mighty pads and glove hand, too. We'll give the credit where it's due. Van Beesbrook, we love you.
Oh!
We love you, Lindsay. Oh, yes, we do. The way you beat Ray Bourque and Ranford, too.
Yes!
That short-handed goal was cool. Bill Lindsay, we love you.
Oh!
We love you,
Doug MacLean. Oh, yes, we do. You'll be coach of the year because it's true.
Unbelievable.
You brought us all this way. Who knew? Oh, Panthers, we love you.
Oh! You know, it's interesting. I said before that everybody on this team, they got, they're hung like they got dinosaur balls, is what I said, something like that. I said they have balls the size of dinosaur eggs, is I think the way I put it. And somebody, I can't imagine who it might have been, but there's like an anonymous fax here. It said, no, you got that wrong. It's dinosaur, whatever. Cut the crap, will you? 24 till noon at WIOD.
So we go to game 7. So it's in Pittsburgh. So what? The best Panthers coverage is right here, and we don't even have their games. So what? News, talk, and entertainment radio.
Yeah, so what?
610 WIOD.
10:45 to go in the third period. Here's Yager out to center, Brad Lauer. Long shoot in, played by Gord Murphy, back out. Then Straka hustling again. Great move by Straka.
By the way, do you know Paul Harvey Jr. was right for once in his life? Because I'm reading the Palm Beach Post, the account of last night's game, and it says unlikely scorers emerge, and the Panthers scratch Martin Strock, or whatever it says, scores along with Bill Lindsay. But anyway, Straka said he wasn't annoyed about being scratched in Tuesday's Game 5, saying that's part of the game. But Doug MacLean saw it differently, saying Straka was trying to stick it to the coach by playing well. I like it when they do that, MacLean said. So in other words, what Paul Harvey Jr. said was true. He likes when a player stick it up his nose. How do you like that? All of a sudden, he's regaining his sense of humor. We win a game, and all of a sudden, he's got a sense of humor back. Nice going, Doug. Here's Pompano. Hello.
Yeah, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we're having a good time up here in Pompano last night. You know, we're up at the bar, and there's a lot of rat throwing and everything. And
yeah.
I've seen a lot of smile on people's faces I haven't seen in a while. I mean, it was just a good crowd and a good
time.
What
a wonderful thing, man. In the midst of all this murder and mayhem and chaos, we finally got something good to squeeze.
I'm telling you, it was a good call on the Straka Wally thing, too. You really pulled it off on that one.
Yes, I did.
Okay,
yes,
Neil.
I did. You can imagine how I felt when Straka stuck that one in there.
Oh, man, that was the greatest.
I'm saying this is me, man. Coach Rogers.
I'm telling you, did it up, bud.
Okay, pal.
Go Panthers.
See ya.
See ya.
Open line in Broward. 524-9463-524-WIOD. We're going to have some damn good stuff going on here today. We're going to have some food in here. We're working on trying to put a thing together if we go to Denver next Tuesday. We're trying to put some kind of a deal together for that and see how that's going to fly, if it does. It's not on value yet, is it? Okay, here's North Miami. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, sir.
I don't know if people know it, but the ESPN re-ran that game last night starting at 2 a.m.
I'll be damned.
Which means they'll probably do the same thing sat tomorrow night. So if people that miss it the first time, they might want to set their VCRs.
Okay.
And that lady that was trying to think of that bit, I think it's the rabbit bit, Elmer Fudd bit. That's the laugh I think she was trying to describe.
Were they laughing in the background?
No, he did a real dumb laugh right at the end of it.
Oh.
I think that's the bit.
Well, we'll see.
Okay.
I'll give it a shot.
All right.
And the rabbit, too.
Good.
Okay.
Take care.
We have an open line today. It's, you think that's what he was talking about, was the Elmer Fudd thing? Because you weren't paying any attention. You're being bothered again in here by a whole bunch of other people. Huh?
I have no. People are calling in saying, oh, I think it's this one, I think it's that one. I have no idea what any of them are talking about.
Yeah, what's going on here? You ought to put a lock on that door.
No, I'm talking
there.
About the callers.
I'm talking about the people keep coming in here all day today.
Well, you know, they want reports.
About what?
You know.
Hey, tell them to mind their own, but tell them Nunyan. Nunyan business.
Yeah, we're in.
Right, we're in. They love us, okay? That's because they don't know we're really pain in the ass. They love us. They want you. And what about Steve Nichol? What's the story with him? Hasn't he come in here to tell us good, bad, thumbs up, thumbs down, mind your own business? Huh? He's on the floor with a bottle in there?
Hello?
Hello, I was calling about the wabbits you have for sale in the paper.
Okay.
What kind of wabbits are they?
Okay, I have some lops.
Yeah?
And I have some lops. some spotted lops and some solid color lops.
Oh, wonderful.
And I have a straight-eared doe, and I have two dwarfs.
A widow dwarf?
They're a small rabbit.
Oh, okay. We have a farm.
Uh-huh.
And we like to play with the rabbits on a farm. You wouldn't happen to have any, like, little rabbit handcuffs?
Any what?
Little handcuffs for the rabbit.
Handcuffs?
Yes.
No, sir, I never heard of them. What,
Well, we use them when we hunt them on the farm. We like to hunt the rabbits. And we take them and nail them to a tree by their ears and then skin them alive.
They what?
Hello?
No, if that's what you're going to do with these rabbits, sir, I couldn't say you're a rabbit.
We have a little game we play called All Rabbits Must Die.
No, sir, no, sir, no, sir. I wouldn't say you're a rabbit for $50.
I like to hunt the rabbit.
Well, that's okay. You go out in the wild and you hunt rabbits, but these aren't for kill.
I'd like to put them in a little pen and then hunt them down unmercifully.
No, sir, I'm sorry. Couldn't say you're a rabbit.
Sometimes we even spear them through the head with a rusty water.
You think that's it? Could that be it? Might that have been it? I sure hope so, because if we can tickle her fancy just a little bit, that'll improve her day and her weekend and her life, right? Whatever. In the meantime, here's a lady in Coconut Creek. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm calling to apologize.
For what?
For my call yesterday.
You're the bitch?
I'm the bitch.
Oh, you'd be better doing a sports show, because that's all you talk about is the Panthers and the hockey.
I'm so relieved your meeting went well.
Oh.
I'm so relieved that the Panthers won. I watched every second of it. And it really was just a joke.
Oh, you'll be amused to know, speaking of our meeting, you know, were you listening yesterday when that old guy called, the one that's chronic, asking me about when we go over there, is George going to do this and is this one going to do that? And I said, the guy's absolutely chronic and is he writing a book? Remember that guy?
Yeah.
Come to find out, he's calling Pete Bolger every day over there asking a bunch of questions to this guy. Get a life, will you, pal? There's a message from Pete Bolger I'm relaying to this guy. Get a life.
I was in the car and I thought maybe you needed a shot in the arm because you sounded like you were just beside yourself with nerves and eating and going into crazy. So I thought, well, I'd give you something to just go crazy about. But I guess I went overboard.
Yeah, right.
I had some of my chronic friends call me during the afternoon and say, was that you, that bitch? Because
yeah.
They recognized my voice.
I said, yeah, we know that bitch.
Yeah, I heard about it.
Well, that's great. It goes to show you somebody's listening anyway.
Crucifying. I'm sorry. Egg on my face. I'm glad they won. I love
you. That's okay. Egg's okay on the Atkins.
All right. Well, stay where you're at.
Okay.
Love you.
See ya.
All right. Bye.
Okay. We have an open line in Broward. Well, listen, we're not going to, like, forgive her right off the bat that easy. We don't let him off the hook. Hey, Tom, can you get me off the hook for old time's sake? Can't do it, Sally. Yeah, it's funny because I go into the Paxson building this morning, and there was Tom Hagen standing there, and he said, oh, that was a wreck, but nobody got hurt. So anyway, it's 11:47. Yeah, that was amazing. I walked through that. They have this enormous building. There's about 400 radio stations all housed in that building. And now, I don't know about you, George, because you evidently were paying more attention, but it, like 8 million different little production studios, and they pretty much all look the same. And the best part of it is there was like no cart machines because everything is digitalized. Now, am I going to know how to do that, being old and fuddy-duddy like I am?
Oh, it's real easy.
Oh. Hey, I got news for you. I happen to be pretty damn expertic. I can go in that room and do more in like 10 minutes than some people can do in 10 hours.
I was very impressed. Most so-called talents wouldn't know what a button was.
That's right. But anyway, no, so that's really good, and we won't have to worry about carts and about cart racks and all that, and then we can put everywhere. Then, when the audience calls in and says, hey, by the way, remember that thing, and I'll say, oh, yeah, it's right here, and I've just put my finger on it, and the bit, too. Yeah, better keep that omelet out of there. He was starting to look pretty good this morning, you know what? He looks a lot better in person over in the studio there than he does dressed up in that zoot suit at the hockey game. But, hey, I guess he belongs to Paul. It's 11:48 at W. Hey, listen, omelets are okay on the Atkins.
News Talk and Entertainment Radio.
News Talk and Entertainment Radio.
610 WIOD.
It is the classic novel you never read in high school, rewritten just in time for the NBA playoffs. Jane Eyre Jordan. Jane Eyre Jordan, Emily Bronte's epic story about two lovers who want to go one-on-one for life.
Oh, Rochester, you've taken your ball of love down my lane, straight to the hole of my heart.
I'm so happy I'm going for a 360 jam.
Not until after the wedding, you scoundrel.
Jane Eyre Jordan, because it's good.
If
By the way, how's the heat doing? Oh, I'm sorry. It's 11:52 at WIOD. A lot of people there who thought they knew where the good stuff. And let's see, it's the 31st of May, which last time I checked my calendar, today's like the last day of May. The last time I checked my colander. And this is it. And I thought for sure that it was like sometime this month we were going to hear the official announcement, at least according to Ike Seaman over there at Channel 6 News, our great investigative journalist, from Mickey Arison and Tony Ritter, and it was all a done deal in the Miami Arena, and the Heat are good doing this, and Pat Riley's getting a haircut. And all of a sudden, like tomorrow is the 1st of June. What's that? Oh, look at that. That's for me?
For you.
Holy Toledo. And another one for my good close personal friend, Denise Potvin and his gang over there at Potvin Sports. Oh, now, don't put that over there. I can't see it. That's it. Pull it up close for an old blind man like me. It's another lithograph, and it says Stanley Cup Championship Playoff Tracker. Oh, I like that. And it's got all the emblems of the teams from the different series, starting with the opening round right through the where we are now. And, of course, it's got like a... Now, has it got stickers to put on there or what?
I don't know. Maybe they're in the envelope.
Oh, isn't that something?
Oh, here we go.
You got it? Oh, yeah, look at that. There's a thing on the back that's got the stickers, and you peel them off of there and you stick it. In fact, that's what Denise told me last time I saw him at the arena. He says, hey, Neil, stick it. But look at that. It's a beautiful, it's the playoff tracker, and it's got a thing of like a generic hockey player on there with a big Stanley Cup in the background all over the outline of North America. And then it's got the various matchups, like I said, underneath, and you peel the things and you put them in there, whoever wins. And here's a note from Jeff over at Potvin Power Play Productions. Says he thought you might like to track us to the cup. Attaboy, Jeff!
Oh!
And don't forget those Billy Lindsay lithographs, too. Those are phenomenal. If you're a Panther fan or a collector, you must, you absolutely, positively, they're going like hotcakes. What was that number, 1-800-what? Remember the one I kept getting wrong? For the other, huh?
For who?
For the Billy Lindsay lithograph, the other thing that he sent us by. 1-800-puck-this. Now, what was it? Ah, damn, am I a schmuck.
Hat trick with no C.
Hat trick with a K, that's right. 1-800-H-A-T-T-R-I-K with no C. Hat trick with no C. And they'll give you the info, and those things are, how much were they? I think they were like $49.95 unframed and 80, something like that frame. But boy, and it's got the goal from the Boston series, you know, the one where Ray Bourque is on his ass and Billy Lindsay has faked him out of his jock, and Ray is down there on the ice in one spot and his cup is in another spot and Ranford's in another. It's beautiful. Here's a lady in Kendall. Hello.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, finally.
Finally we got to you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, I am so excited. Let me tell you, I was born on skates. I was born in the town.
Boy, that must have been tough getting you out.
I
must have been a C-section.
Yeah, right. And it was, as a matter of fact. But
there you go.
But I was born when the Montreal Canadiens, there in that town, when it was English, okay,
yeah.
Before it got
the way it is. Oh, in the good old days, right. Till the Frogs took it over.
I went to school with a guy named Dennis Potvin.
Huh.
And it makes me wonder.
Oh, leave him alone, will you? He's got a lot of stress.
Does he? Did he used to play hockey?
Sure.
Did he? Yeah.
Well, I heard he played a game or two. I'm not really sure what team it was.
Really?
Yeah. He played a few games.
Yeah. Well, like when I was a kid, it was Maurice Richard.
Maurice the Rocket Richard, that's right.
Yeah. And then when we lived in Toronto, it was Bobby Hull. And it was, we were used to the Stanley Cup coming to us every year.
Right.
I have never been so excited in my whole life as I have this past
Well, let
week.
Me see. This might, let me see if this brings back any memories here.
Canadians still have it. They roll it back.
Danny Gallivan, how do you like that?
Oh, God.
Remember that?
Those are the old days, huh?
Yeah, those are the good old days.
Yeah.
Danny's not feeling too good
anymore. I haven't watched hockey for years, let me tell you. I haven't watched it for years. I have a hard time seeing the puck.
Yeah.
And I called my daughter the other day when it was on Channel 7. I said, look what they've done for me. They put a thing around the puck, and I know you hate that.
Oh.
Right? You hate
history,
it with
forget passion. That. It's going.
Yeah.
It's on the way out.
Well, that's okay. I don't talk like that anymore. I've been in this country longer than I was in that country. But anyway.
Yes.
I have never been so excited. My dogs are scared out of their mind because they've never heard me go nuts in front of the TV set
right.
before. And last night, you know, if I don't have a heart attack now, I am never going to have a heart attack.
Well, good. That sounds promising.
So we are so excited, and I don't care how many games I saw in Montreal, and that there was never anything like this.
You're right.
Never.
This is where it's at.
This is it, boy.
Forget about that Dickie Moore, man.
Yeah,
forget
whatever.
About those guys, right.
Yeah, you remember the mask that Jacques Plante used to wear?
Yeah, I sure do. I'll forget about him. He's not feeling too good either. Okay, have a great time, sweetheart.
Thank you. You too.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Two open lines indeed. Look at that. That's pretty embarrassing to me, even though it is coming up on the news, and we're worried about the food coming in from Flores and having a big party here. We're having a celebration party.
Oh!
How do you like them apples, huh? Oh, we got apples coming in. They're not on the Atkins. But then again, either were those 17 pieces of nut bread that I ate out there or whatever that stuff. Boy, that was good. That was really good. What is that, about 600 grams of carbs? That's okay. I'm fat as a pig today, but this weekend I'm really going to get on it. Here's Delray Beach. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, sir.
First of all, go Panthers. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We were screaming our heads off last night. My poor dog didn't know what was going on.
Yeah, too bad.
Exactly. My wife asked a real good question last night. Who engineered this team from the beginning? Who started it all?
Who started it all was Bill Torrey and Bobby Clark started it all together. Oh. And then Bobby Clark decided he wanted to go back to Philadelphia, where he came from, to the Flyers. And they said, okay, we'll pack you a bologna sandwich. And then they brought in Brian Murray, and they said, here's a guy that put this Red Wing team together, which looks pretty good. And he came in here, and he did a little bit of fine-tuning, and he got rid of some of the stiffs we had, like Sorella and Benning and those guys. And he brought in some young guys, and now we got what we got. And he stole Ray Shepard and Marty Straka right there at the trading deadline, and you saw last night evidence of what good that did.
Without a doubt. I was listening to the coach.
Stole those two guys, Ray Shepard and Marty Straka. He stole them for a salami sandwich.
Unbelievable. It was
Brian Murray, God.
Absolutely. And really, I mean, you know, I started running down to my wife, like, the history of all the various guys that are in the management of this team. And how much these people, how much experience, and how every person that was connected with the Panthers, a team that they engineered, is in the playoffs now, or you know, we just beat Philadelphia,
right,
and Detroit and everything else like that.
Yeah, Bill Torrey from his great days with the Islanders, and then we got Brian Murray from his great building of Detroit, which, you know, granted, they blew it in the playoffs again, but he can't be responsible for that. But they got 131 points and 62 wins and broke all the records during the regular season. They've got a pretty damn nice team. And these guys know what they're doing. They know their crap.
Absolutely. You know, so like, you know, it's funny, you know, you listen to the people on ESPN. I don't have a dish or anything like that, but you listen to them, and they're, you know, they're marveling at Lemieux and Jágr, and I mean, they're tremendous, and you can see how their will, power, and talent just overcame a couple of times. But just the sheer planning that these guys have gotten, the sheer coaching that he does.
Well, we got the coach of the year, Doug MacLean, and of course, one of the reasons he's coach of the year is he takes input from the right guys who really are objective and really see things on the outside, you know, without any prejudice, like guys like me, if I want to take credit myself for Woolley and Straka, which I'll do again.
Well,
should have been articles in both the Herald and the Sun Sentinel this morning saying it should have said a big headline.
Neil, God!
You know, right over the thing with the Panthers, because everybody in this town knows that I'm the guy that embarrassed the coach to put those two back in there, but they don't want to give me the credit. You know, they're a bunch of sourpuss.
That's no lie. As a matter of fact, when he was on the Jeff DeForest show,
right?
I mean, he was out and out admitting that.
That's right.
That you were right.
He'll tell
right.
You, my good buddy Dougie. He'll tell you, Neil's the guy that put us on the right track.
Without a doubt.
Okay, I'm looking for the check in the mail this weekend, Doug. Okay, pal.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, in closing.
Can you play a bit that you played? I've only heard you play it once about a benevolent corporation, and we wouldn't do anything to you. It was very good.
Oh, yeah, it must be about the Cox sisters. Okay, I'll look for it, pal.
Okay,
have a great life. Get out of here.
If you're emotionally crippled, welcome home. WIOD, Miami, Fort Lauderdale. News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
Good afternoon at 12 o'clock. I'm Jennifer Ramwith, 610 WIOD News. Brought to you by AT&T Wireless.
Friday, you bastards.
Back in 63, I was just a kid. Weren't no consequence, no matter what I did. I love vanilla shakes and them onion rings. I used to eat all day. I'd never gain a thing. I'd eat them Hershey kisses all day long. But the weight piles on. The weight piles on.
Yes!
The years are passing by. Now I'm all grown up. Watching what I eat. But I never get enough. I gotta watch the fat. Try to eat what's light. No matter what I do, my pants just don't fit right. I guess my days of pork and up are all gone.
Weight piles on. That's what I think he said, his days of porking or something.
Yeah, the weight piles on.
He says the piles just keep on coming. 1206 at WYD. Speaking of people with piles, maybe of money, here's this thing in a Herald Penguin fan's finger, Huizenga. Say he shot him the bird. Can you believe that? I mean, giving the Penguin fans the bird... might be going a little bit too far, Wayne, don't you think? Yeah, that's right. It says, absolutely he did, say three Miamians who cheered for the other side on Sunday. No way, says Stan Smith, a Huizenga spokesman. He says, Mr. Huizenga doesn't communicate in that fashion. And it goes on about after the game and et cetera and so on. And it says the Panther players took the loss in good stride and in a good spirit and this and that. And they were gentlemen. But these sourpuss Penguin fans are saying Wayne flipped them off. How do you like that? Attaboy, Wayne!
Oh!
All right. I say if he did, that he gets like a lot more points with the rest of us. As in, oh, that's the end of that? Okay, 1208 at WIOD. I thought there was more, but that was it. Yeah, that's right. I said to Pete Bolger this morning, I said, so when does the bird come back? And he gave me a real sour look. Here's a mobile in Miami Springs. Hello.
Coach.
Yes, sir. Oh, did this guy get cut off?
No, I'm here.
Okay, you got some bad crosstalk.
Oh, God. Okay.
So talk fast.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, talk fast.
All right, okay, okay. Maybe my battery's going dead. I just wanted to make a comment about, oh, God, I don't know. wait, that's...
That was the best right there. That could be the great. Nice job, pal. Well, he was a little bit flustered because I gave him the hurry-up thing there, and his battery is dying. Don't you hate that when you're on your cell phone and the battery, you know, you hear that little beeping sound, which means your battery's going to be dying any second, and it's like you got like some major emergency. You're on the phone with your bookie or with whatever. You're waiting to talk to the humpster, and you know it's crapping out. When in doubt, it's just... Oh, and speaking of crapping out, I thought I saw Danny Boy there at the game last night with an ugly green shirt on. I thought that was him. And then I thought, no, he wouldn't be sitting over there. He'd be sitting with Wayne because it was down in that section, but he was like all alone. And then when I get home and I'm winding through the tape frantically to get my highlights and to see what else was going on there, and I see there's Danny Boy looking like a fish out of water. Here's Boca. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
This is your Oriental Panther fan.
All right.
What I wanted to know, a couple things, is when Doug MacLean gets Coach of the Year,
yeah,
what kind of recognition is he going to give you?
I'll tell you one thing. When he makes the acceptance speech, he ought to go right up there and say, I couldn't have done it without my buddy Neil, who really knows his stuff, without that puck face.
Exactly.
That's right.
Yeah, I mean, what more could you say? Like you said, Stracco played an awesome game. I mean,
And you know something? If by some miracle we do win the Cup, which, I mean, is a pretty far stretch, but if that should happen... And they engrave all those names on the Stanley Cup. I guarantee you mine better be on there right next to Doug MacLean.
If not,
right above it.
If not, we'll have to go to Toronto and engrave it ourselves.
Have to go right to the Hockey Hall of Fame and stick it in there.
So did you happen to see Latchman there in his Panther
uniform?
Yes,
I did. He was sitting with Wayne.
Yeah, with his little Panther shirt on and everything.
So it continues our string. We've never had the coach of another local team at a game that I know of. Although, no, wait a minute. Now, Pat Riley was there what day? Which day was he there? Was it Sunday when we lost, or was it Friday? I think it was Friday night when we kicked ass. Like I said, we've never had a local coach of another team be there and lose the game.
That's true.
All right.
We'll have to have someone else there.
There you go.
Another thing is, I had a radio accident with the other station.
Yeah.
And they had Rob Niedermeyer on there.
Right.
So what does the big dog ask him? He asked.
He's not back with his sheep again, is he?
No, but he was asking him about whether... After the game, he spent time with his parents or with his girlfriend.
I think the big dog is a horny. I think there's a gap in his life if you ask me.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't believe it. I was like, wait a minute. Why not ask him about his game-winning goal or something?
In fact, Rose's new wife is complaining about the fact that he keeps pushing her over and make way for the Robbie Nieder blow-up doll in the bed. There's something wrong in that household.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I think there's
a bigger gap there than meets the eye.
That's for sure. One other thing, I'd like to thank my wife, Viv. I get home from the game, and right on the bar when I come in are these rat cupcakes.
Beautiful.
It was awesome.
All right.
And then one last thing is, do you know what airport they come in at?
They come in at Fort Lauderdale, but at the terminal where they have the private planes and that stuff, whatever, uh-huh. do they call that the commercial? I don't know what they call it.
Uh-huh. But so
am
we
I
have
right, George?
I don't know.
Oh,
they call it
know.
Something else, though. Like
they
the
do call it something
terminal.
Else.
Okay.
But we don't know if they'll be back that
well,
night.
Well, we put the word out there for us, and if somebody knows what's going on, if you know if they lose, I'm sure they'll be back like tomorrow night in the wee hours of Sunday morning, and if we win, we're going right on to Denver. And we're hoping to find out from some of our good, close, personal friends out there, but we haven't heard yet.
Uh-huh.
So they better get with it.
So I guess we'll have to wait till they get back from Denver then.
Right.
Okay, well, great. One last thing I'd like to
which
call
my... Which will be next Friday.
That's right. One last thing I'd like to call my brothers, Jer and John Douchebags.
What was the first one?
Jerome.
Oh, Jerome. Well, yeah. That speaks for itself. Have a great day, pal.
Neil, thanks a lot.
All right.
Go Panthers.
Open line on the green line, 1-800-944-9463. See, now all of a sudden it took three wins against the Penguins because the last couple of days been a little laid back, you know. Well, we're not so sure. Do we want on this thing? Do we want to jump off it? Kind of like a hot potato. You take it. No, you touch it first. Hey, Mikey, he likes it. That kind of stuff. But now you can't get them off that thing for love or money. They're hanging on by their barnacles, man. They will not get off that wagon. They're squeezing it. You can almost feel it. 1213 at WIOD.
That best describe the atmosphere these days around 610 WIOD. Don't know, can't answer, won't speculate. But we're still here. And still being like the other radio stations wish they could be. Sorry, we were first. Oh! News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
It's a party out there.
It's the time of year for hot dogs and beer and another lost day at the old ball game. Baseball must be hell. Players look kind of fat. They adjust themselves and they play with a crack. Fans pay big bucks, sit in the sun and melt. Well, those overpaid players kill in the dugout and belch. And they start chawing and spin that tobacco. They adjust themselves again. The boys of summer are so wacky. They are quad scratching heroes. They're stars in our eyes. Quad scratching heroes. Quad scratching heroes.
Okay, scratch this. 1218 at WIOD. Let's see what these faxes say here. As much as I love the Elmer Fudd tape, that was not the one. Oh, Zena. That was the lady's name that called before. Sorry, Zena. But I could swear I heard her whole tape. Please find it. It's too good to lose. I don't know what it is, though, Zena. See, if you told me what it is, then I'd know what it is. Do you know what I'm saying, sweetheart? I don't know what it is. Here's another one. Here's a poem to the tune of tonight before it says, the naive of the game and all through the flat, the penguin, not a penguin was stirring, only the rat. That's kind of cute. All right, Mark, nice going. Let's see, what else? We got, this is beautiful. I like it. On this fax, here's a great look. It's a big sandwich, a big submarine sandwich, and inside the bread, it says Greg Kotex's words. Are they tasty? Go Panthers. All right. Get some creative people out there. They're all... In fact, when we were leaving the arena last night, which is a madhouse because everybody left at the same time because nobody left early, thank God. And I heard people saying, well, what's Greg Kotex going to be saying now, huh? What is he going to be saying now? He says this, and he says, but I beep. I'll tell you what he said in the column this morning. Nothing. Nothing. All of a sudden, we just forgive and forget. You know, some things we don't forgive or forget. Just ask Marlon Brando, Greg. You're still a butt plug. Slimeball. Here, now, what is that? Coconut Creek? Coconut,
one of those.
Just a lovely bunch of coconuts? Hello?
Neil.
Yes, sir.
What a game.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
I'm surprised. It's a good thing I had the towel. I guarantee I wouldn't be here today because I'd have no voice.
I was looking for you last night, and the place was so crazy I couldn't find you.
I was there.
I felt like when I left that place that I sat next to a speaker at a concert.
Really?
That place was loud.
Yeah. You know, I feel bad about this, and probably there were some people looking... there were times like after we scored one or two of the goals when, you know, I get up and I'm screaming and yelling and I'm just going nuts. And the whole place is still standing. And because I take this so seriously, I mean, I'm just living and dying on every pass, on every play. And I was the first one. I just had to sit down. I sat there with that Panther towel in my mouth and I'm biting it. And I'm looking around. And I realize I'm the only person sitting, but I couldn't handle it. The pressure was so great.
Were you
just
the last one to leave?
No, not the last one. We're not that crazy. Not that stupid.
Well, listen.
We hung in there. Everybody hung in there. Because, in fact, everybody, you notice, nobody left until the last Panther skated off the ice.
It was great.
It was.
That was the best sporting event I've ever seen. Ever.
If you weren't there, you can't even begin to imagine.
No. Stanley Cup.
Sounds good to me.
I saw...
Why stop now?
I saw, what's his name, Marino there, too.
Yeah.
Did you see him?
I did see him, but I wasn't sure that it was him, and then on the tape I saw him. It was him.
I saw him, and I saw Kozar. You know what gets me?
Kozar was there?
Yeah, Kozar was there.
Oh, my God.
Listen to this. Now, I go to these Dolphin games, and I cheer them on, and I cheer them on, and I cheer them on. Okay, I'm sitting there looking at Marino and Kozar. And they did not clap. They did not scream. They're just sitting there.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, Danny looked like somebody was supposed to hold him up a sign and tell him what to do. What do you do next?
And you want to talk about kissing up? You know those guys in the arena that wear the yellow jackets?
Right.
Oh, my God. Begging call. Unbelievable.
Well, the one that's always down there by Wayne, the guy with the glasses, you know, the big goofy-looking guy?
Uh-huh, the heavyset guy.
He's like a cheerleader. Yep. Every time he's going like, let's go, man, he's clapping, but, you know, he's doing the whole thing, you know, and he's looking around to make sure everybody sees, you see, Wayne, I'm clapping, Wayne, I'm cheering.
Unbelievable.
But I guess he probably gets paid well, you know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
They probably take good care of him.
I was in a Coconut Creek Publix. You should see how they have that store decorated. The whole front of their store is decorated Panthers.
Beauty.
They got a clip from every newspaper since the Panthers have gone into the playoffs.
This is the first time in history when you can say there's rats in my supermarket and people feel good about it.
They got rat cakes. You wouldn't believe it.
Great.
Unbelievable.
I love it.
All right, here we go.
Okay, pal.
Party tomorrow night.
Strap it in.
Let's do it.
See ya.
All right.
Open line on a green line, 1-800-9. What did we say?
It's a party out there.
That's what we said. 1222 at WIOD. Last Rick Riley made out. How come we didn't get a call from Rick Riley? How come Steve Nichol didn't come running in here saying huh?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, what's going on with these guys? Are they out or what? I don't think so. I think everybody's in good shape. Let's see. I want to play this. I want to do that. We got an open line on the green line. That's our first open line all day. Don't call it right now, though, because we're busy sorting out the food. I think I might have a couple of slices of pizza over there, which I'll just eat the topping of with a fork, thank you. So hand me a fork. 1-800-944-9463 on that green line in Palm Beach. Now, let's see. What am I supposed to do? Just look at this, and the answer is yes, and I'd be glad. Oh, I see. Oh, okay, great. Okay, no problem, Lizette. We love you. That's for you. Okay, here's Aventura. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Martin Straka, God.
Oh!
And I'd like to give a little credit to Terry Karkner and Rhett Warner, who I think played outstanding games last night.
Well, they really did, except I do want to say this, and that is as the game wore on there with those last 4 or 5 minutes, Rhett Warner and Gord Murphy had a little bit of a case of the jitters, it seemed to me, and were coughing it up like they needed a big expectorant or something to get the lungers out of their system. But we survived it. But
I think Gord Murphy could have had a black jersey on last night and no one would have known.
Well, he had some problems there toward the end. Gordy has had, he's got a bad ankle, and everybody's supposed to believe he's 100% healthy, but he's not. But we need him in there. But you're right. Karkner, the entire playoffs, has been playing. And you know something else who nobody's talking about enough? Robert Svala, boy, this kid is playing sensational.
Yes, and he's losing body parts every day.
He is just playing unbelievable, this kid. Where did he come from all of a sudden?
I have no idea.
After that shaky start at best.
I hope you got to smoke the victory cigar I brought you before the game.
Yes, I did.
That's very good. It was like the line to meet the Don. And there was some guy tugging on my shirt going, I need to talk to Neil.
I'm telling you, I've never had so many people come around, which is good because Rick Riley was there and he felt very embarrassed by him. It was great.
Yeah, he kept staring around like, why are all these people surrounding
us? How come they're not talking to me? That kind of stuff. I loved it.
Well, no one knows who he is anyway.
Well, there you go.
It's like going to the Super Bowl twice a week. It's unreal going to the game.
Right.
The best $400 investment
I
ever
made. That's
right.
Super Bowl is just one game, you know, but here we just goes on and on and on.
Everyone told me I was crazy when I was sending in my $400, 2 months ago, and now they're all begging me for my extra ticket.
Right.
In closing, All the Hollover lifeguards are douchebags.
All right.
Thank you.
See ya. I was hoping they sent some Snapple or something, some beverage, something liquid.
No.
They sent no liquid? On the day when we have nothing to drink, when we're dying over here and we have no, Yeah, that's nice. Call our good friend. Call Joe and our friends at Flores Bastards because they didn't send us nothing to drink. Nice, George. They'll take care of your food good next time. Okay, so like I said, we just did Aventura. We're trying to catch up with what's going on here because we're busy eating right now. I wonder if it's going to be like this over there. You think? Are they going to let us have food
in the
thing?
They told us they don't mess with success. This is an integral part of the show, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Eating on the air is definitely a part of what we do. Yeah, it is. What's wrong with that? As a matter of fact, I wasn't going to tell a story on the air. I don't want to give any inside secrets. But while I was over there with the big bureaucrats from Paxson Communications this morning, a couple of the bureaucrats, I don't want to mention their names, were throwing plastic insects against the wall. Are you ready for that? Yeah, I'm serious. I guess they wanted to show me that they can be just as juvenile as anybody we got over here. Here's a mobile implantation. Hello.
Neil, God.
Yes, sir.
What an exciting game.
Unbelievable.
I mean, did they come out hitting? I mean, they were knocking them off their feet. They were taking the puck
Mario
away.
Lemieux says he's never played a team that plays better defense than the Florida Panthers. How do you like that? He didn't say anything about boring or nothing like that. He said better defense.
That's great. Hey, well, this was a treat after the game. I was up in Boca at a sports bar, and we watched the game, had a great time, came back down south, and stopped in another little sports bar. I'm not trying to plug it, but it's called Bruise Room. And who comes walking in but Doug MacLean? I couldn't believe it. My buddy's sitting across the table from me. He goes, Don, oh, my God, look who just walked in.
Doug MacLean?
Yes, sir.
And, is he singing American Pie?
He went over to the jukebox and played that song.
He went to the jukebox? Oh, Doug MacLean, you mean. You mean Doug MacLean?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Whatever that coach's name is, yeah.
But,
well, a lot of people have forgotten his name. Most people, when they talk about the game last night, they say, yeah, we love that coach.
Neil God.
Right, Neil God. That's the coach.
But he was swamped. About every 30 seconds, somebody came over and got an autograph.
Yeah.
He said he cussed more than the players did. And it was pretty exciting. He was watching all the highlights. Anytime a highlight came on, his eyes were glued to that TV. So.
I sure hope he got to see that Marty Straka goal several times.
Oh, jeez. Yeah.
That was a beauty.
Yeah, it was beautiful. So I just thought I'd share that with you.
Okay.
And we're going to go all the way.
Sounds good, pal.
All right.
Say hi Say hi to Eddie, whatever his name is.
Okay.
All right, Eddie MacLean. We have an open line in Broward, 524-9463, 524-WIOD. Here's Morrill Gables. Hello.
Hello, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, let's get the Panthers and Amherst in the finals, huh?
Okay, the Amherst. Don Cherry'd go for that.
Calder Cup, that's
yep.
Right. Hey, during the regular season, I don't know if you noticed, but who was missing during our slump? Bill Lindsay.
Yeah.
God, I'm just saying.
Well, that's right, because there was a point when he came back, we had never won a game, and maybe we still haven't without him in the lineup.
He is the heart and soul, and I swear I saw him hit three guys on a forecheck in the first period. I mean, if that wasn't a turning point in addition to his goal,
right?
I don't know what is. That guy is just the best hustle. And
he is.
Love. And also Brad the Booga and his rats. Got to love him. They're God.
Yeah, that's right. He was there last night.
Got to love it.
And every time Brad's been there, they've won. And I also noticed that the Humster wasn't there last night. Where the hell was he? He was conspicuous by his absence. They had his sidekick there, but the Humster wasn't there. I guess maybe they figured they sent him to the track or somewhere he might know something.
Anyway, you were talking last week about those hand-painted rats. Where are those available somehow?
Oh, Jesus.
Next to Corbett's.
Next to Corbett's what?
Sports Bar.
Oh, down there in US-1?
Next to Corbett's Sports Bar in South Dade?
Great.
Is where they have them?
There's one. That's one place they have them, right?
Okay, great, because this guy sounds like he knows where it is.
Sounds
there you
good.
Go. You got it. How
Thanks
do you like that?
All
okay,
right.
Pal.
Bye-bye.
Rats away. We have an open line at Dade, 751-9463, and one on the green line, 1-800-944-9463. Here's Hialeah. Hello.
Neil, God.
That's me.
What's up, Neil?
We're going out.
What a game last night, wasn't it?
It sure was.
It was just driving me crazy.
Yeah.
I got one little shameless request, though.
And what might that be, sir?
Okay, I'd like to play I would like for you to play the asshole song for Mr. Kotex. Because he is such an asshole.
Yeah.
And I also have a problem. Lost my girlfriend last night.
Really?
Yeah, she was sick and she couldn't go to the game. And she goes to me, no, girl, stay home. And I'm like, well, when you bring the cup home, lady, then you can tell me what to do.
Yeah, when she brings it home, you'll wear it.
Yeah, Neil, God.
So you want to hear an asshole song, huh? Well,
yeah.
You do understand that I met with the people from Paxson Communications this morning. There were a lot of rumors flying around this building that I wasn't going to be able to do things like that anymore.
You're kidding.
So.
Yes.
Have a great day, pal.
You too, man.
Okay, ditch the bitch.
Yeah.
All right. So what did they tell me? I think they said, folks, I'd like to sing a song about the American dream. About me. About you. About the way our American hearts beat way down in the bottom of our chests. About that special feeling we get in the cockles of our hearts. Maybe below the cockles. Maybe in the subcockle area. Maybe in the liver. Maybe in the kidneys. Maybe even in the colon. We don't know. I'm just a regular Joe with a regular job. I'm your average white suburbanite slum. I like football and porno and books about war. I got an average house with a nice hardwood floor. My wife and my job, my kids and my car. My feet on my table and a Cuban cigar. But sometimes that just ain't enough to keep a man like me interested. Oh no, no way. No, I've gotta go out and have fun at someone else's expense.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I drive really slow in the ultra fast lane while people behind me are going insane. I'm an asshole, yo, 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 yo. I'm an asshole, yo, buddy, yo, buddy, yo. I use public toilets and I piss on the seat. I walk around in the summertime saying, how about this heat? I'm an asshole, yo. Sometimes I park in handicapped spaces while handicapped people make handicapped faces. I'm an asshole. Yo, 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 yo. I'm an asshole. Yo, yo, yo. Maybe I shouldn't be singing this song, ranting and raving and carrying on. Maybe they're right when they tell me I'm wrong. Cadillac Eldorado convertible. Hot pink with a whale skin hubcap and all leather cow interior and big brown baby seal eyes for headlights. Yeah! And I'm gonna drive around in that baby at 115 miles per hour, getting 1 mile per gallon, sucking down quarter pound of cheeseburgers from McDonald's in the old-fashioned non-biodegradable styrofoam containers. And when I'm done sucking down those greaseball burgers, I'm gonna wipe my mouth with the American flag, and then I'm gonna toss the styrofoam containers right out the side, and there ain't a goddamn thing anybody can do about it. You know why? Because we got the bomb, that's why. Two words, nuclear f***ing weapons, okay? Russia, Germany, Romania, they can have all the democracy they want. They can have a big democracy cakewalk right through the middle of Tiananmen Square, and it won't make a lick of difference because we got the bombs, okay? John Wayne's not dead. He's frozen. And as soon as we find a cure for cancer, we're going to thaw out the Duke, and he's going to be pretty pissed off. You know why? Have you ever taken a cold shower? We'll multiply that by 15 million times. That's how pissed off the Duke's going to be. I'm going to get the Duke and John Cassavetes and Lee Marvin and Sam Peckinpah and a case of whiskey and drive down to Texas.
You know, you really are an asshole.
Why don't you just shut up and sing the song, pal? I'm an asshole. I'm an asshole, and I'm proud of it. All right. That's for Craig Cody, by the way. And you know something? While I was playing... Oh, I feel better now. Much better. While I was playing, I'm looking at this article here, Superstar Stifling Strategy Successful, which has like a nice alliteration to it, but other than that, is a bunch of crap. And it's just mind-boggling that there's, like, no reference in here anywhere to the fact that this guy's been saying, oh, geez, it's so sad, and the cat's out of the bag, and the cat's in the kettle, and the rat's up your nose. What is that? I mean, how the hell are we supposed to forget that this is the guy, the one guy that stood out like a sore thumb, that's really been like, you know how they have those statues in Rome and Greece, you know, with a little, and they're always like peeing on stuff? That's what he's been trying to do to our parade profusely, this guy. As if, well, it was really nice, but, you know, the bitter disappointment is coming, and you better get ready for it, and we're all going to have a big letdown. And we have this phenomenal, ecstatic thing going on last night. And now this guy acts like, well, here we go. We just diddling along, and aren't we great? Yeah, okay. Whatever you say, Greg. So we don't want to say asshole because we don't want to offend nobody, but that's what he is. 1237 at WIOD.
Week, millions of people around the world tune into Baywatch just to see Pamela Anderson Lee's really big breasts. Now, Pamela Anderson Lee brings her really big breasts to the big screen in a futuristic techno thriller.
So you're a leather-clad bounty hunter out to extract vengeance on the terrorist who killed your boyfriend.
That's right.
Uh-huh. You know you have really big breasts.
I sure do.
Yes, Pamela Anderson Lee has really big breasts, and now they're bigger than ever in Boob Wire.
If you're a bounty hunter, how come you don't have a gun?
I don't need a gun.
Why not?
Because I have really big breasts.
Huh?
And I know how to use them. Take that, and that, and that, and that, and that, and that.
What happened?
I fainted with my left breast, followed by a quick jab with my right breast, and a flurry of right-left hooks with both breasts before finishing you off with a quick left breast hook to the face.
I think you put an eye out.
Well, my nipples are registered with the police as deadly weapons.
Pamela Anderson Lee and her really big breasts star in Boob Wire. Boob Wire, now jiggling at a theater near you.
1242 at WIOD, and we're just ecstatic over here. We're having a party in our pants. We're having a Panther party on the table over here. We got stuff from Flores. We got pizza, we got subs, we got all kinds of good stuff. And it's been kind of sliding out of here very slowly while I haven't been any paying no attention. But that's okay, that's fine. Everybody help themselves, have all you want unless it's something that I want, okay? There's nothing that frosts my ass worse right than when I see something in the corner over there. And before you know it, somebody slides in here during a while I'm on the air, and it just disappears. Not, hey, by the way, could I have this? Are you planning on touching this or what? Just like yesterday, JC came in here when we had the food. Remember from the Greek lady? And said, hey, you planning on touching this? I said, hey, it's something to think about, which I have. Oh, by the way, speaking of the Japanese lady, why don't we do that? We have two $40 gift certificates from Taniguchi's place, which Carol Taniguchi, who's like half Jewish and half Japanese, I can't tell you which half, brought in a bunch of great stuff yesterday. I mean, it was fantastic. So Japanese doesn't just have to be raw fish and mung. Oh, jeez, I get nauseous. Although they do have sushi if you like that, if you like to eat it raw. But they've also got fantastic steaks and steak dishes and all kinds of seafood, lobster and shrimp and just really good stuff. Anyway, Taniguchi's place is at 2224 Northeast 123rd in North Miami in the San Susie Plaza East, right over there by Sarah's Pizza Place, the kosher pizza joint. And we got two $40 gift certificates, so we'll give those away, and all you got to do is X. You know, if you're somebody that's going to use it. If you're somebody that's just going to, like, wipe your nose with it, forget it. Here's a mobile in Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Great.
Have a question.
Never better.
Would like for you to clear something up for us, okay?
Okay.
If you can. The story behind how the rats started on the ice.
Yes, sir. Early in the season, Panther dressing room, there's a rat in the locker room. Scott Mellenby, number 27, goes over there. He takes his stick and he spears the rat and kills it against the wall. The story gets out and some creative fan decides that he's going to take that and he's going to start making like toy rats. And it just picked up from there and caught momentum and caught on with everybody. And then all the, you know, all the entrepreneurs out there started making rats and selling them. And then they forced people to smuggle them in their underwear and everything, but they can't keep them out. I mean, when they're making the announcement, on the one hand, please don't throw anything, you'll be ejected, and then you look down there and the owner of the team and his wife are heaving rats all over the ice after the goals, you know they're just kidding you. They're just pacifying Gary Bettman with those announcements.
Appreciate it much. Thanks a lot, Coach.
Okay, pal.
All right, bye.
See ya. Marty Straka. God.
Oh!
And, you know, that must have given him some personal sense of satisfaction. I don't want to get in the lineup again, but have such a big night against his ex-teammates, the Pittsburgh Penguins, who thought he was dispensable and nearly ruined his life. And I got news for you. When somebody trades you away to the Ottawa Senators and then onto the Islanders after that, that nearly ruins your life. But thank God, you know, it's a good thing we got Brian Murray up there who's got some good sense when it comes to talent. We can't always be sure that, you know, the coach is going to play these guys, but the general manager knows the talent when he sees them. Did we ever get any more word about the team coming back or about any stuff? Anything? Nothing? Boy, that Rimmer, man, when you really need him, when you need some assistance, when you need some information. Like that call the other day, remember when he said he's given us information and it was all about Chris Draper and his face is falling apart? We don't care about that. What series are the Red Wings playing in now? The dead series, I think. They're done. They're finito, baby. That Dino Ciccarelli, he's finished. Here's, is that another one? A mobile in Parkland. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Great game last night. I'm still hoarse from the screaming. I want to know, why didn't Skrudlin go over and argue when the first goal was scored? They let Mario just sit there and take the ref's ear away. I mean, you know.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Did the goal count?
But the fans didn't know what the hell was going on.
Did the goal count?
Oh, thank God, yeah.
You don't. Skrudlin was standing right there. He was standing right behind.
Yeah, he skated back to the bench. And then,
but wait a minute.
Go ahead.
He was standing right there, and then Terry Gregson said, hey, the goal is good, and Skrudlin lifted up his stick, and then he went back to the bench, assuming it was all over with, and then they get into another technicality about whether it hit it off the guy's uniform or off it. They had like three, like Fat Rich said before, they had three different aspects of it that they had to review. Did the net get off the moorings before the puck went in or afterward? Did it go off of...
When Gregson looked up in the air and all of a sudden he started to wave his arms, no, it was like all of us in the stands were going, oh, my God, tell me it's not true. I mean, they didn't even show it on the scoreboard.
But that was originally.
Yeah. Well,
he waved it off. That was his call, but he still went upstairs to review it, and as soon as he did that, I knew we had a good chance.
Yeah, but then when he came back down, they didn't put up on the board.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it was like, if they're not going to allow this, at least say something or show it. You know, show what was going on on the screen inside the stadium.
Well,
I mean,
don't worry about it now. We got it. It counted, and we'll take it. And you know, don't cry over unspilt milk.
Now we'll see you next Saturday at the arena.
Sounds good to me.
Sounds great.
All right. We have an open line at Broward 524-9463-524-WID, or it's 1247.
News Talk and Entertainment Radio. 610 WIOD.
My vagina really gets my panties in a wad.
Okay, whatever you say. 1250 at WIOD. What's that? Boy, you're sure doling out the meat pretty slow over there. Very piecemeal. Anyway, let's go to a lady in Pompano on a purple line. Hello.
God, Neil.
Yes, ma'am.
Couple things. First of all,
God.
Yes.
I've been listening since Zeta Days, and this is probably one of the best shows I ever heard you do.
Great.
I'm a huge hockey fan. I grew up in Buffalo, which is why I haven't called you before.
I threw up in Buffalo, too, as a matter of fact, time I went there.
My first hockey game, I sat in the front row between the two boxes.
Yeah.
And I could smell them all and hear all their language. I was about 12 years old, and I was instantly hooked.
Once you got a whiff, you were in.
Definitely. Okay, that's number one. Number two, have you noticed ever since the series, all the girls, all the ladies that have been calling you?
Yeah.
What's up with that?
Because there's a lot of lady hockey fans now.
Because we all...
Even that bitch that called before that pretended yesterday that she wasn't, and then today called and said, now she's a celebrity, she loves me.
Yeah, now she's kissing up.
Who's she kidding? Phony bitch.
So anyway, the game was incredible last night. I was biting my nails, standing on my toes. My boyfriend grew up in Hollywood, and so he didn't know what the heck was going on and kept giving me dirty looks.
Mm-hmm.
I was scaring my dog as well.
Well, you better show him the ropes. You know what I'm saying?
And the last thing I want to ask
you. Show him what it's all about.
Well, he showed me a couple ropes, but anyway.
I'll bet.
There's a couple years ago, I can't remember if it was a player or a coach, and they were having a scuffle on the ice with some of the refs. And this one nook guy went up to the ref and said, oh, y'all have another donut, eh, you fat pig?
No, you got the story. It's very interesting. That was the Rangers were playing in the early playoff round. I forget who the hell they were playing. It doesn't really make any difference. Maybe it was Montreal, but it was one of the early playoff rounds. Don Koharski was the referee.
Uh-huh.
And he made a call that pissed off the Rangers, and evidently as he passed Colin Campbell, the coach of the Rangers, as they were going off the ice, Campbell yelled at him, have another donut, Koharski, or something like that.
Colin Campbell?
Yeah.
All right.
I'm pretty sure it was the Rangers.
I've been wondering about that.
Because that's Colin Campbell.
I've been saying that ever since Buffalo days, ever since I moved down, and everyone looks at me like I'm nuts. They don't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I think the Rangers have a colon problem, if you ask me.
Neil, you're a god. I love you.
Okay, sweetheart.
Bye-bye.
Have a great life.
You too.
Purple line is open. We pay for it. Pick it up and pick up that instrument and just bang away at it and see what happens. Mobile One Cell, AT&T Wireless, pound IOD. We're having a little party over here. I'm sure a lot of you are going to be partying heavy duty over the weekend with this Panther stuff tomorrow night. Go to a bar where they got like a satellite dish and you can watch it from CBC, like a real telecast. And Don Cherry and Ron McLean, by the way, will be in Pittsburgh at the Civic Arena for the game. They're not going to have, like, the Grade Z team there. I think they'll probably have the Grade Z announcing team of Chris Cuthbert and John Garrett to finish the series out because they've been doing all the games. And Bob Cole and Harry Neal will be resting their voices for the finals in Denver on Tuesday, which hopefully will be in. Yeah, what are they going to do then? They can't shine us if we get in the finals. They can't stay away then. Here's Miami. Hello.
Yeah, I don't know about you, but I'm going to heaven for Game 7.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
To follow up on the Mellenby story, he scored two goals at that game, and Beezer said, what do you call that, a rat trick?
Right, that's right.
And for a couple of interesting stats, Pittsburgh is 4-3 in Game 7. And
I thought it was 3-3. It said this morning.
4-3. Yager and Lemieux have 258 minutes of scoreless play time.
Oh!
The Panthers come in at Executive Airport, but I can't give you the time and date. And Gary Glitter, you asked earlier about Gary Glitter's
team
that started in Denver with the Denver Broncos.
Really?
Yes.
Look what it did for them. Look at how they choke.
Well, that started years ago when they were very, they were going to Super Bowls and losing them.
Right, that's what I mean.
Right, and The only interesting thing about Fox telecast, they time the rat delay, and I want to know if Rick Sanchez is going to do the color when Fox does the Miami home games with us next Saturday.
CBC does that too. They time the rat delay.
They time the rat
delay. ESPN stole it from them.
How did the Nordiques do last year?
How did they do?
Yeah, what was
they lost to the Rangers in the playoffs, but they had a tremendous year, and they were had a spectacular team, and they had a very exciting, high-scoring team.
They never won the Cup, though, right?
The Nordiques? No.
Okay. All right, I just wanted to give you that info.
But they got a hell of a team, man. I'm telling you that. If we're lucky enough to make it that far, they got one hell of a team.
Right, well, I'm looking forward to it, and it would be unbelievable.
It would.
All right, nice talking to you.
See you in Denver Tuesday.
All right.
The Quebec Nordiques, they had a hell of a team last year. They got beaten by, I'm pretty sure it was the Rangers that got by them in the playoffs. Am I correct about that? I do believe so, unfortunately. Am I right? I don't remember. I know they got knocked out early, and they had a phenomenal year, and they had Sakic, and they had Forsberg, and they had Jocelyn Thibault, who, of course, they traded to Montreal for Patrick Roy. And now, of course, everybody tells you about Patrick Roy and how he's the best in the game, and he's this. Don't let anybody kid you. If you pepper Patrick Roy with a lot of shots, in fact, you look at the Panthers' success record against Patrick Roy when he was playing with Montreal, and also that one game we played out there in Colorado, which was after the trade, and he gave us four goals in that game. He hasn't had very much success against the Panthers. Ain't that a shame, huh, Patrick? Here's Hialeah. Hello.
It's now post time. New off. You.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, we have an open line in Dade, 751 Moron, 751 Really Sad. Who is that? Freddie Capicella's grandson. Here's a lady in Deerfield Beach. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, you wouldn't know because you were at the arena, but the coverage on ESPN sucks.
Yeah. I have it on tape. I tape both of them. I have, two machines set up.
It's a minute 43 to go. We've already beaten them 4-3, and the guys are saying, if there's a seventh game. I mean, what is that?
What do you mean we've already beaten them? Didn't you see where Yager walked in there and damn near scored the tying goal?
Well.
But you had no...
Come on. I mean, we basically had already won. And,
yeah, right,
and they're
sure.
still saying, if there's a seventh game.
Uh-huh.
If there's a seventh... I mean, come on. They've been saying it all the time. These guys are so biased.
Yeah.
I mean, they won't give them credit when they're playing good. They, they never talk about Shepard. They don't, barely mention Straka. I mean, come on. I want to call them douchebags.
Okay.
Okay, ESPN, you're a bunch of douchebags.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Say hi to
Neil God, go Panther.
Say hi to your bird.
Yeah, thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
We have an open line at Broward, 524-9463. That's it. Let's make some noise today.
Oh.
All right. Because even people that haven't got a clue are opening up a big mouth and having a party in their mouth.
It's a party out there.
Exactly. North Bay Village, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
So glad I could get through on this tremendous, momentous occasion.
On the day of our daughter sweating.
It's also my 10-year anniversary.
Of what?
Of being with my girlfriend for 10 years. I'd like to say happy anniversary, Donna, the Dent Wizard. Keep up the good work. And also, Neil.
Jess?
I would like to say to you that last night we were bickering and fighting and everything, but man, when they scored, it changed everything.
I'll bet.
We're hugging and kissing and wrestling.
I'll bet you were, yeah. Seizing the moment, as they say.
And can I add something else as well?
Yes.
I like the songs everyone sends in and the poems about the Panthers, except for when they're done to the melody of the Dolphins Oilers song.
Right, I agree.
Only when
kind
Brad,
of a cheap ripoff, you know?
Only when Brad the Booga does that do I enjoy it.
Exactly.
And I'd like to say, please don't relate us to the Dolphins. We're not dressed in teal. We don't wear a fish. We're the cats, baby. We kill fish.
Oh, all right.
And penguins, too.
See ya. Get out of here. We have an open line in Dade, 751-9463, 751-WIOD. Here's West Palm Beach. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
What is it? Cats kill fish, and they also kill birds. So penguins are part fish and part bird.
Penguins are dead.
Listen, I wanted to call you Coach MacNeil.
Yeah.
And I can't believe...
Neil, God.
Straka, God.
Yes, sir.
That is the only thing that came back. I'm so glad that you finally got into those guys to tell them to put Straka back in the game.
And there was Jason Woolley getting down on all fours, making a phenomenal block of that shot that was headed for the open side of the net. Jason Woolley, there you go. Rest my case. All day yesterday I said, in fact, I've been saying that all week, Woolley and Straka, get them in there, baby.
I tell you what, Woolley just threw his body right in front of it.
It was great. It
could have hit him right in the puss.
I just went nuts.
Well, Neil, I know it's going to be a win in Game 7. I can't wait to watch it.
Okay, pal.
Take care.
I got it all under control.
Okay.
Have a great
night. Hey, is CBC in the clear?
Yes.
It is?
Yes.
Okay, I'll watch it there.
Grab it.
Bye.
Grab it while you can.
Write this down. www.wiod. Miami, Fort Lauderdale. .com.
Worldwide, baby.
News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
It's the 1-2 hour.
10:45 to go in the third period. Here's Jagr out to center. Brad Lauer. Long shoot in, played by Gord Murphy, back out. Then Straka hustling again. Great move by Straka. Bill Lindsay, then Straka scores!
Oh! So I have one thing to say to Doug MacLean. You're welcome, sir.
Yeah, you've really been an inspiration, Neil.
Yep.
I'll tell you, you've caused me more grief in the last 48 hours than any man in the history of professional sports.
I have telegrams from the assistant coaches, from the entire coach. I got a big telegram here from Bill Terry.
I know one thing. You don't mind taking the credit.
That's right.
And
you're right about that.
And I told him at the press conference last night it was my decision. It had nothing to do with one word you said.
I've always said that. Anything I tell him that's bad, we'll give him the blame, and I'll take the credit for the good stuff. That's why you get the paycheck.
You're a beauty.
That's why it's called coaching.
And I'll tell you, my wife's sour at you, the comment you made about the shower yesterday.
Yeah, and then, you know,
you're lucky I didn't have you by the scruff of the neck.
It's a good thing that I heard, because I didn't know the whole original comments, but evidently somebody, I think it was one of our regular chronic fans, heard your comments. Now, let's clarify it for the audience, like live in person. You like it when the guys do what to you? They stick what where?
No, that was just...
Isn't that what you said?
That was off the record.
Off the record, yeah. He likes it when they stick it somewhere. And
I like
when
it when they show me up. That's
yeah, and
I
when
like.
They keep doing it over and over again.
I like it when they show me up.
Yeah.
Yeah. So and you come to Pittsburgh, or... Or what?
I was going to come to Pittsburgh, but then, of course, Rimmer's promising me these seats and already having to cure the hemorrhoids from my last year in Toronto. I don't think I want to have to go through that again.
Are you going to go to his arena football game tomorrow night?
No, I am not.
Oh.
I'm going to leave that up to him. Us real fans will be sitting there watching the CBC about 2 feet in front of the set rooting the Panthers on.
Yeah, that'll be fun.
So how do you like it?
Pretty exciting.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's going to be fun. Who knows what happens in a Game 7, but I'll tell you, we'll play hard.
And they weren't happy about having to play. They were saying that after Game 5. They were, Jagr and Lemieux both saying, we don't want to come back here under any circumstances because Game 7, you get a lucky bounce or a bad breaker, and anything can happen.
Yeah, that's what typically happens in Game 7, so we'll see. But you know that Lemieux and Jagr are going to be on top of their game tomorrow night.
Yeah.
That's the one thing that makes you a little bit nervous.
But how do you like Mario saying he's never played against a better defense than the Panthers?
That was a nice compliment.
Coming from him, that's one hell of a...
That may be mentioned tomorrow night a couple of times.
Yeah, I would think so. Probably on CBC, but not on ESPN because they still don't like us. They still don't want to give us any credit.
Oh, is that right?
You know, an interesting thing, though, now, you know, the Barnes, I don't have to tell anybody, the Barnes-Lowry-Shepard line's been the hot line, and the other lines have been, like, kind of in a coma half the time. And now, last night, this new line you put together with my help, all of a sudden, these guys step up and
now,
score.
Did you put the line together, or did you just tell me to dress Straka? I didn't... I didn't hear that you wanted that line.
Yeah, you got the whole message.
You just wanted Strachan.
You got the whole message. I says to you, look, I mean, Dvorak kept falling on his ass in a Tuesday night game up there in Pittsburgh. Put Mellenby, the old guy, out there. This will wake him up a little bit. You got the message.
I come into work this morning. There's a lot of people outside, and I'm walking along and signing a few autographs, and the people are saying, oh, thanks for listening to Neil. Thanks for listening to Neil. I said, Neil who? And they said, oh, the guy in the radio. I said, oh, the guy in the radio.
Yeah. That guy. They were all kneeling at my feet, I'll tell you that.
Oh, it hurt on the head.
They said, man, you're right. You're Mr. Puckface is what they said.
Neil doesn't like to listen to you because of the bad language you use on the radio, but you happened to be listening yesterday.
Yeah, just have another radio accident. That's what I heard. Well, we can't all be as up straight at least as the guys over there on QAM, the ones that are talking about your players doing it with the sheep. We can't all be as straight as those guys are.
I'm not getting into that.
Oh, there he goes again. You hear that line? He's not getting into that. If I gave you a shovel, man, you'd be halfway to China already.
That's great.
Now, listen, one thing about the Avalanche, and I want, because I am looking forward to that.
Oh,
I mean,
Avalanche. Let's not talk Avalanche.
No, I want to talk about the Avalanche. You know as well as I do, we've had some good luck against Pat Roy.
Yeah, he hasn't played great down here, but this is a different time of year.
Yeah.
Typically, he plays pretty good. So well, they've got a hell of a team, you know.
They do have a great team, I'll grant you that, offensively and defensively. But
I got to admit, though, it was kind of fun knowing that the Red Wings were watching us play last night.
Yeah, and get, you know, the most disgusting thing I've ever seen in my life, yesterday I get to my car in valet. Of course, all of us stuck around late till the last player got off the ice.
Yeah.
And there's this lonely figure out there putting a Dino, a bumper sticker on my car. I don't want to tell you who it was. How do you think all those Dino fans feel right about now?
Oh, well, they had a tough time in the playoffs, but
yeah.
They're not going to get any sympathy from me.
In spite of what Brian Murray's saying. Well, listen, you've done a hell of a job with a little bit of assistance. It's always good to have a pupil that listens to his teacher, and that's good. And I'll be sending you the telegrams. I'll be sending you some wires up there, and do a good job of running. We'll be rooting and pulling and yanking hard.
Okay.
Okay, Dougie.
Take care, Neil.
Do a good job.
See you, bye.
See ya.
Bye.
Doug MacLean there, the coach, and his name, by the way, is not Don MacLean, it's not Denny MacLean, it's not Shirley MacLean, it's Doug MacLean, okay? So if you're going to tell me about all these new fans we got now, you know, I mean, I know your intentions are good, I know you're right on top of it, but get the name right. What is it? Whatever the hell his name is, that's what it is. He's a hell of a guy, man. Coach of the year, I don't care what Don Cherry says, who's kind of like turned on him like a rat, as they say. What's up, Don?
There's a dream that lives deep in air.
Oh!
Heroes call their name. Legends leave their mark. And it's worth the sweat. And it's worth the pain. Cause the chance may never come again. Give it all you got. Take
in the series and 26 points in the playoffs. So he now trails Joe Sakic by a couple in that race. As he tries to join Sakic in the Avalanche in the Stanley Cup Championship Series. There's a rebound.
Oh!
Nedved will take the faceoff for Pittsburgh against Brian Strudlin. Lemieux poised in behind Nedved, but the Panthers win the draw. Fitzgerald gets it down. Zubov hustling back. Brings the boards to Daniel. He was hit by Huff. Now 20 seconds left, and the Penguins will have to hurry. Here's the shoot-in, and Yonkers' first one to it. Off Panther and back out. And this amazing story is going to continue. The Florida Panthers have forced Game 7.
Yes! Yes!
Yeah, but wait, yeah, but...
So, like, did I say it's 1:15 at WYOD?
Wait a minute, you and Cinderella got it on?
Oh, babe.
Well, I guess Cinderella's not that pristine young lady she appears to be, huh?
Passion Phones, 8 p.m. till midnight on News Talk and Entertainment Radio, 610 WYOD.
Tom Cruise is back, and this summer America's favorite brain-dead pretty boy will face the most difficult mission of his career.
Your mission, should you choose to accept it, Tom, is to assassinate the South American dictator named Carlos.
South America? You mean, like, Florida?
No, you fool. I mean south of the equator. Anyway, this tape will self-destruct in 10 seconds.
Self-destruct? What does that mean?
It means it's gonna blow up, you idiot! Quick, get out of the room!
Well, I can't. The door won't push open. It's not working.
Paul, you idiot! You have to...
Will you be able to get your money back at the box office, or will it become a mission impossible? Find out this summer at a theater near you.
118, by the way, we got a tremendous number of spy report on that movie, like one or two, and nothing. Piece of dreck. So anyway, does anybody want those gift certificates to Taniguchi's, those $40, because nobody's asked for them yet, and probably the people that do want it can't get through because the lines are smoking, and you want that just as well. In fact, the coach, if he would have been in town, he'd have probably asked for it. Here's Plantation. Hello.
7:55 on Zeta 4, the Neil Rogers Show on a Wednesday morning.
All right, now they're digging up the old tapes over there at Zeta. Great. Great, they're digging up the old tapes at Zeta. They're running through the building. And, of course, there are no tapes because they don't have no tape over there. I wonder when they're going to start playing.
Neil wakes me up in the morning.
When are they going to start that?
Neil wakes me up with a smile.
Oh! Yeah.
Drinking my coffee, munching down my donut with Zeta 4 on the dial.
So, anyway... We have an open line in Broward, 524-9463, 524-WIOD. Let's go to Okeechobee. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
How are you?
Great.
I wanted to ask you two questions. One, where did Doug MacLean coach before he came to Florida?
Doug MacLean was an assistant coach with the Detroit Red Wings.
Okay, that's what I thought, but I wasn't sure.
And he got kind of like a savaged, he got screwed.
Okay. And another thing, that theme that you just played, Hockey Saturday Night? Where
right.
is that from?
That's from the CBC, eh?
Oh,
Canadian Broadcasting Corp. I do, too.
I heard that the other night, and that thing just sends chills up and down my spine.
The CBC really knows how to do it. You know, ESPN, Fox, all these other Johnny-come-latelys, they're just pretenders. The CBC, almost invented... they did invent televising hockey. They know how to do it. They know how to make it exciting. They know how to, jazz it up. They know how to... They just know how to do it.
I had to go to West Palm Beach to see the game, 78 miles away, and I watched it at age.
Well, why is that?
Well, because I don't have a satellite here at the house. And I'm planning on getting one at the end of this year, though. I'm going to get a small dish.
But why did you have to go? Why did you have to watch it on a satellite?
Because I'm in a rural area and I don't get cable.
Oh, I gotcha.
Okay.
That's incredible.
I went to a sports club and I saw the whole game. A terrific, fantastic game. The only thing is, I missed all of the commentary. There was some dodo kept playing the jukebox, and of course it was
somebody
like,
was playing the jukebox while the game was going on.
Yeah, there was about 10 or 15.
See, if that was in Miami, that's how we solved that.
Yeah, that's
no
what we
questions
should have done.
Asked.
So I heard absolutely no commentary at all, and I'm just,
well. Of course, if it was
pictures.
On, now were they watching ESPN or CBC?
I believe it was ESPN.
Well, then you just as well. You don't want to hear those assholes.
Well, I wanted to hear. I didn't get a chance to hear any of the crowd noise when they were cheering, and you know the camera.
There you go. We got the crowd noise for you. Here you are. How was that?
I couldn't hear any noise. Is there any way I can get a...
Any way you can get what?
You taped the whole shebang. Is there
right.
any way I got off the air? I could send you a tape and have you make a copy for me so I could watch it again and hear the sound this time. It was super. It was a great game. I just missed so much not hearing anything. You know.
Yeah.
Not so much, you know, the Belrose's comments or anything, but just the crowd noise and what was going on. And then I saw the replay several times on the Mellenby goal, and I could, from where I was, I could tell that it was good, but I couldn't hear what the discussion was. All I could see was lips moving.
Yeah.
And I was right up close, too. There was that much noise in that bar.
Well, I'd have shot a few of them. Okay, pal, have a great day. The answer is no. Okay, we have an open line and a green line, because if I do it for him, then I'm going to have all these people. Like, it was kind of interesting, like Game 3, which we kicked their ass 5-2. Wasn't that Game 3? Yeah, it sure was, on that Friday night. And come to find out that it was Wayne who needed a copy of that tape. And, of course, I don't want to tell you who so called me and said, do you have a copy of that tape? Because guess who needs it? Now, wouldn't that... No, I didn't, because I use the same tapes and I race over them over and over, which, although last night's, I think I should save. I think last night's is a keeper. So this last guy who called, the answer is no. I'm keeping that tape forever and ever, because that was it. That was as good as it gets. And thank God we didn't have no overtime. Oh, boy, I'm thinking there with about 7 minutes left, they tie it up 3-3, and I'm thinking, oh, this is starting to smell like overtime. I don't like overtime, and especially during the playoffs, because it goes on forever. And then it can be like that Pittsburgh-Washington game, the second overtime, and the third, and then, just forever. Anyway, it's 123 at WIOD.
O'Neill, my queen, God. It's beautiful and it's fine. Ooh. It goes crazy when it's pet. Ooh. When it's bigger, it's better yet. Ooh. It filled my hand, it touched my chest. Ooh, when it blew, it ruined Ooh. My vest. It came out of my jeans and into my life. Oh, how it makes me feel fine. It's 16, so beautiful, and it's mine.
Okay, 126 at WIOD on a really tremendous Friday. It's one of the greatest days in the history of my life. I'll tell you that right now, and I'm sure that there are many other people out there who agree. We heard a very gracious call. If you tuned in late, we had just 20 minutes or so ago, a gracious call from Coach Doug MacLean, who thanked me profusely for twisting his arm and convincing him that Jason Woolley and Marty Straka had to be in the lineup for us to win last night and keep the series going. And now I think I've personally given them the impetus and the direction and the instruction, and I'll leave it to them. I think they're on the right road. They're on the road to victory tomorrow night, and it's in their capable hands. All right. Here's a mobile in West Palm Beach. Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Great.
Talking about Straka,
yes?
Why did he scratch him from game, was it 5?
I think Straka said something about, hey, coach, you got bad breath or something like that. And he took it personally, and he's held a grudge against him ever since, you know. I don't know what it is. I just don't think he was sold on Straka until I convinced him.
after I seen him play last night, I said, what a fool for not playing him.
That's what I told him. Only not as nicely as that.
Well, it was a great game last night. I look forward to tomorrow night. And go Panthers, go.
All right.
Bye.
See ya. Yeah, Strachey, you know, like Mellenby said, he opens things up out there because he's got speed and the defense has to make different moves to try to adjust to him. And even when they do make those moves, like you saw last night, he zigs and zags. He makes Jager-type moves. And I know that's really getting carried away. They both happen to be Czechoslovakian and young and both very talented players and very quick skaters. And I think that there is a similarity. In fact, somebody called yesterday when Straka came up with the Penguins a couple of years ago, and they called him Jager Jr., and I think that that's accurate. I'm not saying he's going to be as good as Jager, but I think he's a player cut out of the same cloth, and he's got the same kind of moves, and, you know, you either got him or you don't. It's not something you learn. It's like with Mario Lemieux and guys like these. You're born with that kind of skill and that kind of speed and that kind of deftness, and you either got it or you don't, and he's got it. Here's Tamarack. Hello.
Neil, coach.
Yes, sir.
Doug, God.
All right.
Great game last night. Look forward to Saturday.
What a team. Doug and Neil, man. And Neil, like I said, Neil and Doug, what a team.
Definitely. Just hope they don't take you off the radio and sign you in as an assistant coach or something.
Yeah, for $2 or $3 million a year, it sounds okay to me.
Yeah, you'd like that. You got me interested on it. First game I went to was Islanders and Panthers right before the series started.
In fact, there's a rumor starting that now that I got Straka playing so great, that Bill Torrey has put out a special call and seeing if I'll work on Jody Hull for him.
Yeah, I believe it.
And I said I would work on Jody, but not necessarily have anything to do with hockey.
You had your meeting today, right?
Yes, I did.
Did Jennifer Rim have her meeting?
Jennifer had hers.
She's not leaving, is she?
What do you mean by that?
Well, they're not going to take her someplace.
Not that I know of.
Well, let's hope not. Otherwise, we're going to get Luca over there.
No, I think Jennifer seemed pretty pleased. I spoke to her this morning and...
Great. Can I get a shameless request, please?
And she said...
Dumb jock.
What is it?
Shameless request.
Okay.
In memory of Phil and Aaron, I got you down.
Well, why do you make it sound like they've died or something?
Well, they didn't die, but...
But they're kind
they
of
They won't be with us.
Boy, yeah.
Yeah.
Together.
Okay.
Thanks, Neil.
Have a great day, pal.
Bye.
Oh, now, wait a minute.
Yeah, but let me say something first. Let me say something.
No, I don't think so. Not on this Paxton station, not saying nothing, okay? Turncoat. He'll be big in L.A., baby.
I'm Aaron Summers.
He'll be
done
with it.
You got me talking on the passion phone. Tell me the story about how you got blown. I got you down. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Holy cow.
Ha ha.
I'll tell you once more before I hang up the phone. I got you down. The lines are jammed up. Yeah, there isn't a doubt. Call up and tell me what it's all about. I got you down. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Holy cow. I'll tell you once more before I hang up the phone. I got you down. 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 Here on the show, there's a new topic each night. Who'd you have sex with? Were they black or were they white? I got you down. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Holy cow. I'll tell you once more before I hang up the phone. I got you down.
My vagina really gets my panties in a wad.
131 at WIOD. Happy Friday to you. Happy Panther stuff. Happy Year of the Rat and all that other good stuff. Here's Fort Lauderdale on the Purple Line. Hello.
Neil, my great psyche.
Yes, sir.
You did a fantastic job.
Yes, I did.
Even with the score.
Mm-hmm.
Unbelievable. ESPN did a hell of a good job last night.
Did they?
They even gave us a couple of backhanded comments. Compliments.
Yeah.
They even said that Colorado would rather play Pittsburgh than play Florida because of our defense.
How do you like that?
I know. I was really shocked. Then they did a nice zoom-in of Wayne's wife holding a big canvas bag full of the rats.
That's right.
Yeah, then they panned past Doug as he was mounting some very nice innuendos after... Pittsburgh scored the goal.
I love it.
I have one shameless request.
Yes, sir?
Toto Allegato.
What is it?
Toto Allegato. And Japanese Siamese, I thank you very much for the tickets.
Okay.
I'd love to get those tickets for the dinner.
What tickets?
The coupons for the $40 for the gifts.
You mean
Japanese?
You mean the one?
The one.
I'm not giving you both of them. I'll give you one.
Okay, I love it.
Because your phone is so bad, it's a miracle you've been on this long.
I know it. I've been on for an hour.
Have you really?
Yeah, that's
well, when you
the
heard
battery.
There was something. Well, yeah, and we're paying for it.
I know.
Okay, hold on.
Thanks.
Freeloader. I mean, hang on. Okay, Purple Line, take care of that freeloader with a crappy phone. See, I don't even know what the hell he was talking about, and neither did he, but hey, he got the thing. He got the ticket for the free food, for the free Jap food. Good stuff, by the way. I'm telling you, Carol Taniguchi, she brought in a feast yesterday, and I'm not exaggerating to you. It was some of the best damn stuff I've had in my mouth in a long time, and that covers a lot of territory. Here's a lady in Miami. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi. Well, this is the first time that I listened to your show and everything. And,
this is the first time you listened to my show?
Yeah, and they told me that it was really funny that you fart all the time.
Unbelievable.
I mean, I'm not really big on the Panthers. So
did I fart all the time? Not on this show.
Oh, okay.
Where'd they come up with that?
It's just a good friend of mine. I don't know. He just, he told me, like, great things about the show and everything.
Yeah. We don't fart on this show. What do you think? Is this some kind of a common show?
Yeah, well, sort of. I mean, you
we don't
make it
like,
that way.
We don't make bodily sounds on this show.
Okay, I see that. I hear that.
Okay.
Okay. Well, bye.
Hey, well, you're easy.
I think so.
Okay, sweetheart. This one's for you. See ya. Bye-bye. Oh, she loves it. She loves it. All right. So if there's any guys out there that, like, have a real problem and just can't control it, there she is. She's waiting on you. She's sniffing around. We have an open line at Dade, 751-9463-751. It's 134 at WIOD. Get that winning feeling at Pompano Park. Although, you know, I love the way Gary does it in those spots. Pompano Park. Hey, Pompano Park. I know you got to talk fast in those spots, Gary, but, you know, calm down a little bit. You sound like you're on helium. Pompano Park.
So we go to Game 7. So it's in Pittsburgh. So what? The best Panthers coverage is right here, and we don't even have their game. So what? News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is your brain. Any questions?
Late night buffet. I should have known all that food could be bad. I didn't know that fish and brown gravy could make my body feel so sad. Porcelain riding can be so hard on your thigh. And those cramps make me want to scream. And my butt's too sore to wipe.
Rectum.
Diarrhea.
Diarrhea.
Wonderful lady that called only moments ago that thought she was going to hear a lot of if she tuned in the show. Don't want to disappoint. We're here to please, as in...
Lay off, people. Lay off, folks. None of those sarcastic jokes. That alum, that Mr. Wayne Huizenga.
Oh!
We used to pick on that bald head. Now we throw rats at it instead. Got alum, that Mr. Wayne Huizenga.
Yes!
Wayne used to have your hair cut short and not be gay at all. But now Wayne's got that hockey bug, and he digs Van B's Brooks gonads. I used to think his wife's a dyke, but I just removed the seat from my bike. Got a lot that Mr. Wayne Huizenga.
So anyway, it's I guess we won't be talking to him anymore soon. Just a joke, G-Man. He's well, at least he's come back now. Did they pay him or what? Huh? He must have got a check. Okay, let's go to Hollywood. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Congratulate you on that great job you did with the Panthers. Yeah, it was a great job.
I sure did.
Class act by the coach.
Neil,
gives you all the credit.
That's right. At least he admits it. I mean, he can't deny it. It's right there on the pubic record.
Yeah, I don't want people to forget. Wooly did an outstanding job on that stop with Lemieux.
That save will go down. You'll see that in all the highlights. There's two things from last night you'll see on every highlight reel for weeks to come. One is Marty Straka's goal and a great give-and-go pass there with Lindsay. And the other one, of course, is Wooly blocking that shot.
Yeah, the whole team came out, and Mellenby giving it up for the goal there.
Right.
Yeah, that was great. And could I suck up for some sushi?
All right.
Here's another freeloader
who came in like the side door. Okay, hang on. Line four, take care of that guy. That's all we got. And thanks to Carol over there at Taniguchi's, where they got some really good Japanese stuff. Of course, I don't know if you eat enough of it, if you might drop your own bomb, but that's another story. See, we want to put a lot of that stuff in there because that lady evidently tuned in expecting to hear tons and tons of that. And since it is a classy show, here's Boca. Hello.
Hey, Neil, how you doing today?
Pretty good, sir.
So what do you think Yaramir Yaga has to say now? Didn't he say he'd rather play the Panthers instead of the Flyers?
Yeah, but Yaramir Yaga also said he don't want to play no game seven is what he wanted to said. Yeah.
So do you think Esther's jumping on the bandwagon now?
Who?
Esther?
Esther, well, she's got no Stevie Eiserman. She's not got no Stevie at the Y.
Oh, they interviewed him yesterday. I was watching one of the channels flipping in between commercials.
Yeah.
In between watching Miss Heisinger go in the bag and throw the things and go in the bag and throw the things.
Right.
Then she grabbed Wayne and threw him, and she had a blast.
She's loving it.
Oh, man, did they get lucky last night, huh? Mr. and Mrs. Heisinger I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Well, you hit the nail right on the head, but we're lucky it didn't go into overtime.
Yeah.
Because then we're going to have to hear Rick complain about how much time he spent.
Okay.
And
have a great day. Oh, he's so chronic. We have an open line in Broward, 524-9463, and one on the green line, 1-800-944. How come I'm so patient, you know? How come I sit here and I try to be such a damn nice guy? That's my problem. That's my biggest problem is I'm too nice. Not rotten like some people say, but way, way too nice. Too patient. Here's Miami. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I would like to give an
I
would like to give a tip, you know, to the people.
A what?
A tip.
A tip? Yeah, I got a tip for you. Open line of Dade, 751 WIOD. We got one on the green line, 1-800-944. Here's Miami. Hello.
Hello, Neil.
Yes, sir.
How's it going?
Okay.
I want to thank you for that rat you sent me the other day.
Okay.
And also I want to tell you that yesterday I went to Cake South Sports Bar.
To where?
Cake South.
Yeah.
And they threw me out of there for being... for being too loud.
Well, screw them.
You got any places that you know that I could go to for Game 7?
And be as loud as you want. Whereabouts?
Right down at Kendall, right down 137th.
Down there at Kendall. Somebody's going to call in. They'll tell you. They'll tell you where to go.
The old lady there threw me out.
Somebody will call in and tell you where to go.
All right.
Okay, get out of here. Oh, by the way, speaking of South Dade, going gone on US 1 at Southwest 128th Street, that's where they have the painted rats. Because everybody and their brother, in fact, last night, who the hell brought that by? Somebody brought me a gigantic, I mean a big black one, rat that is, with red eyes. I mean, almost as big as my little dog. And we took it home, and the dog thinks it's got a brother now or something. And, of course, my big dog keeps, like, scratching at it and clawing and chewing, and I'm hoping that he, like, gets a little bit confused, you know what I'm saying? But anyway, it's 145 at WIOD. We'll find out. Do we got a place in down there? We got a bar? I don't think we want to send him anywhere. He's out of control. Here's a mobile in Miami. Hello.
How you doing, Neil?
Okay, sir.
It was a great game last night. I owe it all to you for talking us into the hockey there back months ago.
Very unknowledgeable people down here that don't understand that the real exciting, the best stuff on earth is out there and that many of us have tasted it and smelled it and seen it. And, you know, we got to open it up for you.
I stopped going to hockey back in the 70s, and I'm glad that I'm lit back up. My wife is... never been into sports at all in her life, and lived in Canada for years and never even watched a game.
You lived in Canada for years? Wait a minute. You lived in Canada for years?
My wife was born and raised there.
Where boots?
In Windsor.
And she never watched a game on CKLW Channel 9, Hoba Hockey Night in Canada?
No, she always avoided. In fact, she's listening right now at a job site.
Oh, my God.
She's just a big-time hockey fan
now. Well, I'll tell you one thing. It's lucky for you that she didn't find it because, you know, she might have had something exciting in her life.
Yeah, and Atkins lost over 50 pounds on it.
Beauty.
It's great.
All right, keep it up.
Your God, Neil.
Keep doing it, pal.
Stay easy.
See ya. Open line and date, 751-9463, 751 WIOD. Well, I'm sitting here trying to get a fix on tomorrow night, you know, because I've been giving these scores out, and I've been sniffing around fairly close in many of them, but I just don't have any inkling, so I'm not going to give a score. You know, I could do it. I could just pick one out of the air, but that would be stupid. That would be like Greg Kotex just making up a bunch of crap and then, you know, hoping for the worst. That's what he was doing. Not hoping for the best for us, hoping for the worst for us and the best for him like he knew something. Which we know now that you don't know anything, Mr. Rexbert. Get on a Zamboni and blow it out your ass. How do you like that, Greg Kotex at the Herald? Who I am just amazed that this guy's got the chutzpah to write this column this morning about last night's game, and there's no allusion, there's no reference, there's no hint of anything that he's done these past few days, as though we'll just forget about it. Here's a guy to read, like, oh yeah, this guy really wrote a great article. He knows his crap. I'd say he's probably an expert on crap. 147 at WIOD. By the way, one thing we did decide at our meeting this morning, no more crap.
News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.
Agarra la miel, Junior.
All the spics are brown. Out here in LA.
Out here in LA. Incredible.
I've been.
.53 at WIOD. Here's a fax from George, from whatever this guy's name is. And anyway, it says Danny Marino was clapping feverishly after we scored the third goal, after the Straka goal, which I believe was the third one, if my memory's correct, and I'm sure, of course, it is. So there you go. These people that said that Danny Boy was sitting there like a dead fish. What's wrong with these people that got to pick on Danny Boy, even if he might have been sitting there like a dead fish? Here's Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Panther pandemonium is reigning over South Florida.
Pandemonium, yeah.
There we go.
Pandemonium.
Listen, I had my bratty little kids off from school today, so I went up to the practice.
Yeah.
These guys, let me tell you something. I mean, it's already like 10:30, quarter 11. They're running late. They all stopped. Everyone, even Coach MacLean, comes
right
over, signs everybody down the rail.
Oh, well, Coach MacLean, I mean, he's anybody that even recognizes him, he goes nuts.
Now, let me tell you, but every player, Lowry, Rocket. They'll
right
come out of the car.
They're the best. I mean, they're the best in the world,
they
these
are
guys.
And, you know, I took the kids to the Dolphins one time when they were in the playoffs a long
it
time ago.
Forget
and
it.
And they chased you away. That fat security guy, Stu, whatever his name is, chased you away. These guys are a class act all around. And one other thing, all the Penguins are gone now, right? You know,
right,
the thing that really bothers me is, if I was a Penguin fan, they are like almost too finesse. They, with their power play, passing around.
You're wrong. You're absolutely wrong. They're very patient,
well,
and I'm going to...
Well, they're patient, but... Like,
yeah, but let me ask you this question. Let me ask you something.
Ask me.
How many Penguin games did you see during the regular season?
I saw quite a few, to be honest with you.
Well, I got news for you. Their power play, when Mario's in the lineup, is phenomenal. Of course, keep in mind, Francis is out.
That's true, too.
But the way they pass it around and they find an opening and they stick it in there, the thing that we did best last night in our, and the penalty killing was the number one best thing we did, by the way, was that we didn't let them set up and get in the box and pass it around. We came out and we were like doing a great job of poking it out and not letting them get set. And we in fact, like there in the last minute of the game when we kept the puck out of the zone most of the time, it was phenomenal.
Well, I just want to give our team all the credit because the defense is there, and I did listen to everybody on ESPN, and this guy, this analyst, Fang, whatever, former player, Pang.
Oh, Darren Fang, yeah.
Whatever.
Fag, yeah.
Well, whatever he is the only one that has given us credit during the entire broadcast. I mean, as far as giving.
Yeah,
us,
but he's kind of a pain in the ass. That
well,
kid.
He looks like one.
Yeah,
but
he looks like
we'll
a figure skater.
We'll take all the credit we can get.
Okay.
Go Panthers!
All right. Now, I'm glad this got called because he reminded me that we should have talked about that earlier. Of course, none of us, we're all caught up in the euphoria of the moment. But the penalty killing last night was stupendous. It was great. It was sensational. In fact, at the beginning of the third period, you know, the Beezer clears that one. And it was pretty sloppy, John. Cut the crap, Beezer. You're great, but cut the crap. He cleared that one over the boards, which, of course, is an automatic delay of game penalty if it doesn't hit the glass and it's not deflected and just goes over into the crowd inside the blue line. And, you know, there was kind of a delay there, and most of the schmucks in there are not realizing we're about to get a two-minute minor penalty for delay of game, and I'm saying, oh, no, we're getting a penalty now. This is bad. And I thought to myself, God, we worked so hard to tie it up, and Lindsay got that nice goal in the second, and we're like even Steven here. And now, right off the bat, 30 seconds into the third period, we're going to give him a power play, and I said to myself, if we can survive this power play, we're going to win the game. Does that sound good? That's what I said. Here's Dave the cop, who's becoming mighty frequent. Yes.
Hey, listen. What
How's the Blues doing, by the way?
Yeah, the Cardinals, hey, they're only a few
How's that needle-nosed Gretzky doing?
Forget him.
I have.
What do you think of Gregson? I think he's been reffing pretty good.
I don't think he blows. I hate Terry Gregson. In fact, he made a real bad one. He missed a couple on them. Then he called a terrible one, I think it was on Skrulin. And then, like, 40 seconds later, he did a makeup one, a phantom penalty. That's not being fair. That's like trying to compensate and making it worse and worse and worse, like Paul Stewart does. You can't do that.
All right, well, listen, I've been on the money during this whole thing, basically, and the momentum has shifted. I like the Panthers 4-2 tomorrow, and Barrazzo's going to get yanked after the second period.
He's going to yank it?
He's going to get yanked.
I love it.
4-2 Panthers.
Sounds,
you got it.
Sounds beautiful to me. We'll let you be the score maker tonight.
Well, thank you.
All right.
Okay.
See ya. There you go. Dave the Cop says final tomorrow night, Penguins 2, Panthers 4. It sounds reasonable to me. We keep playing that really tough, gritty defense. We keep, you know, sure, they're going to get a couple of breaks on you during the game, and that's when we count guys like Karkner to get back and poke it away, do that nice job, and the Beezer to come up with a big stop. That's what we're counting on, you know.
By the way, we have requests from inside the building for that hockey song.
From inside the building?
Yeah.
For which hockey song?
The one.
The chance. What do you mean, the one?
That one. The CBC
well,
one.
Well, never. What do you mean from inside the building?
People in the newsroom.
The people in the newsroom are hockey fans all of a sudden? I'm going to tell you something. You could go out and look into a dumpster and find some poor, downtrodden, homeless slime ball in a dumpster. You say, how about those Panthers? As a matter of fact, you know, this is true. The last one, I was in Toronto for the last game of the regular season, and the Leafs beat Edmonton 6-3, and they needed that game to assure getting into the playoffs, which they won. And I'm going down in the subway in Toronto to go back to the hotel. And there's a homeless guy sitting down there, you know, the kind in Toronto, like I always say, hey, have a nice night, mister. Spare some change? Well, that's okay. He says, hey, what's the score now? I says, 6-3. All right. You know, give me one of those. All right. This poor guy is barely breathing. All right. Go Leafs, go. It was a beautiful thing. It was great. So what do they want?
There's a dream that lives deep in every heart. Heroes come.
Spontaneous human combustion was meant for Michael Jackson. WIOD, Miami, Fort Lauderdale. News, talk, and entertainment radio. 610 WIOD.